consecutive FCS championship. But they'll have to go through Jacksonville State, the number one seed, a team that put up a 13-1 record during the course of the season. It's a packed house at Toyota Stadium for the FCS championship. The NCAA FCS championship presented by Northwestern Mutual. It's Jacksonville State out of the Ohio Valley against North Dakota State out of the Missouri Valley. And for the Bison, the four-time defending champions, they get Carson Wentz, their quarterback, back in action. Wentz has not played in almost 3 months with a broken right wrist. When he's right, this is a kid who's touted as a potential first rounder.
Yeah, he's got the prototypical size for an NFL quarterback. And look, the kid's powerful in his throws. He can make all the necessary throws throughout the course of the game. He's polished. He's seen it all at the line of scrimmage, and he is efficient. That includes a quick release, but also a very quick thinker.
Jacksonville State won the toss. They deferred. And North Dakota State will start from its own 25-yard line. Easton Stick had been starting for North Dakota State. He was 8-0, but Wentz is back. You look at the measurable, 6'6", 235. He's a North Dakota kid. He was the MVP of the championship game a season ago. And as we told you, this is a guy who might be one of the top three QBs taken when the draft rolls around.
What a tough decision for Coach Kleiman. And he goes with the senior here after Easton Stick, in my humble opinion, had done enough to deserve the start here. But if you're going to give a guy an opportunity, let it be perhaps maybe the best college football quarterback this year. And we've seen Paxton Lynch, Christian Hackenberg. I'm looking forward to seeing Carson Wentz today as well.
North Dakota State comes out with two tight ends, King Frazier in the backfield. And Wentz will hand it off to Frazier. King Frazier with a nice gain on first down. He's been solid in this postseason. Back-to-back 100-yard games in the semis and quarters.
Anish, you're absolutely right. He ran with true authority against Richmond. And I think he started to gain some confidence as the playoffs have gone on. He's playing his best football down the stretch. And if you're a senior, he's a junior. If that's a contribution you want to make latter part of the season.
Wentz will hand it off. That's a fly sweep. Darius Shepherd, about a yard shy of the marker. It'll bring up 3rd and 1. Both coaches told us this game will be won in the trenches. North Dakota State, the strength of their team, the offensive line. You look at Jacksonville State's defensive line, 3 SEC transfers. They've got D tackles at 290 and 322. You don't see that in the FCS. Goal line set here on 3rd and 1. On the ground once more, Frazier has some room. And a big tackle by Darius Miller, who may have saved a touchdown. Either way, a first down for the Bison.
When you go back and you study the Gamecocks on film, they haven't seen a team that lines up with this type of style of football, aggressive. They like to run the power between the A and the B gap. And last week, against Richmond, we saw the Bison, 26 of 52 runs were right up the middle behind that meaty and very efficient offensive line.
Again, the big set. This is the freshman, Bruce Anderson. And you hear the chants of Bruce from a mostly pro-Bison crowd. We've been at the Fargo Dome the last couple of weeks, and that is one of the great home field advantages in the FCS. Well, Frisco has been a home field advantage for the Bison during this run as well. Their fans buy these tickets in August.
Amazing.
Anderson again. And he's got another North Dakota State first down. Bruce Anderson has been a special teams weapon. He's starting to see more carries on the offense, but he's returned 2 kicks for touchdowns in these playoffs.
Yeah, and the tempo here for this Bison offense is very surprising, but it seems like they feel like they've got the Gamecocks defense on their heels. And they are attacking right now very aggressively.
They're running a no huddle out of the goal line formation. You don't see that often. Chase Morlock stopped right at the point of attack. This is a Jacksonville State defense that can get it done. 11th nationally overall. Top 20 against both the run and the pass. We mentioned how good they are up front. They've got two first-team all-conference linebackers and an All-American cornerback in Jermaine Huff.
Yeah, and Huff's the real deal. And he'll have to make sure today that he's got all guns ablazing if he's going to try to cover some of these wide receivers who run exceptional routes for North Dakota State and do a good job of creating separation with the way that they move prior to the play.
We saw John Gross a moment ago, the head coach for Jacksonville State in his second season. Wentz to the air for the first time. Corner blitz. Wentz has to get rid of it. It's incomplete. That was Huff coming off the edge.
Yeah, he's a game changer. Yeah, you saw him there just coming from the blitz. And anytime you run those Cobra blitzes, it's got to be timed well. But you've also got to disguise. And because Jacksonville State is so aggressive with their corners, they like to play a lot of press man on the outside edges. You see him there coming from the slot, but it's a lot easier to get a good jump when you're blitzing from the cornerback position.
That was the first pass after six consecutive runs on this drive. North Dakota State will likely go to the air again here on 3rd and 9. Shepherd in motion. Here's Wentz, stands in, finds Shepherd for a first down. How big is that for Carson Wentz to get that first completion out of the way?
Well, we know this kid has skills, but when you've rested as long as he has, nursing an injury, to come back and to put the ball on the money, your first critical and crucial big third down, this kid already has confidence, but that's the reason why he's starting. With all due respect to Easton Stick, and this young man has certainly grown, hard to find a player with those types of skills all across the country.
There's Chase Morlock. Spins inside the 25 to the 23 for a gain of 4. Morlock, a junior, who's a legacy guy for the Bison. 6 of his relatives went to North Dakota State. He's an Eagle Scout who grew up just across the river from Fargo in Moorhead, Minnesota.
And in speaking to the coaches this week, they wanted to get him some touches early on to get him acclimated to the game, but also to try to get a real strong two-power back game going along with him and King Frazier.
10th play of the opening drive, Frazier in the backfield. There's Wentz to the air, moves the pocket under pressure, chased by Darius Jackson, and Wentz has to get rid of it. Jackson, a school record, 18 and a half tackles for loss. He is a menace, and he lives in the backfield.
He does, and that time there, you want to talk about the escapability of Carson Wentz. Darius Jackson is one of the most athletic defenders in all of FCS. That time there, Carson doing a nice job of buying time on his feet, making the smart decision to throw the ball away, and he'll have to keep an eye on number 40, Darius Jackson, the young man from Alabama, because he applies pressure to the quarterback at a consistent basis.
This could be 4-down territory. It's 3rd and 7. And North Dakota State kicker Cam Peterson has struggled in the postseason, just 1 out of 7. Here's the blitz. Wentz. And that is caught inside the 20-yard line. Another first down, a gain of 7. And that is R.J. Urzendowski. Just his 3rd catch of the postseason. He had 3 catches on the game-winning drive here in this stadium a season ago.
Yeah, now this is a fantastic route. You see him there just really get on the DB's toes. But the throw from Carson Wentz is what threw him open. The ability to throw it to the outside. You saw the defender on the top there going inside. Carson there seeing it and putting it in a very safe location.
Morlock and Dunn flanking Wentz, who's out of the shotgun, 1st and 10. They give us to Lance Dunn, up the middle, dragging the defender, and he's to the 12-yard line, a gain of 5. Ahmad, we wondered how rusty would Carson Wentz be. He's been taking the 50-50 snaps the last couple of weeks in practice with Easton Stick, but again, no live game action since mid-October against South Dakota, coming back from a broken wrist. He looked sharp early on, and Chris Kleiman, their head coach, told us a few weeks ago that if Wentz was able to go, as good as Stick has been, he's going to go with Carson, and it wasn't really a decision for him. Frazier. A good job there by Jacksonville State. Quan Stoudemire, who's getting to start at weak side linebacker in this game, making the tackle.
Now's when you start to see how this defense will adjust. Early on, the Bison have done what they've wanted to do, move the ball down the field. But if you can make a stop here on third down and force them to a field goal, if you're the Gamecocks, you win on this drive, in my opinion. And so now, can they handle being the fatigue that may come along?
Easton Stick, the quarterback, into the game. He's the slot receiver at the top of your screen. So maybe North Dakota State up to something. Stick motions. Wentz fakes it. Throwing for the end zone. Incomplete, intended for Erzendowski. And now fourth down coming for North Dakota State. Cam Peterson, the place kicker, has struggled. He hasn't made a field goal outside of the Fargo Dome in almost 2 months. And he's been a liability in this postseason, just 1 out of 7. This is a 29-yard kick. It's up. And it's good. Chris Kleiman likes to see a confident kicker. North Dakota State with a 15-play opening drive. The Empire strikes first. Chris Kleiman excited after his kicker, Cam Peterson, nailed a 29-yard field goal. North Dakota State scores first in this FCS championship. And he's Schroff alongside Ahmad Brooks. You know, if you get rid of prologue and you forget for a moment that North Dakota State is the four-time defending champion, I think Jacksonville State should be the favorite in this game. They were 13-1 in the regular season. Best team wire to wire. Their only loss was in overtime on the road against Auburn. And that was a game, frankly, they should have won.
I agree. And I think the Gamecocks coming in, they got the 13th-ranked defense. You saw them there hold. But it's this offense that's made them go. They've just been able to outscore opponents, and you're about to see the skill position players for the Gamecocks are outstanding.
This is Rashad Byers, and he's across the 20-yard line. And this Jacksonville State offense, you said explosive. Their big three, maybe as good as any big three in the FCS.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with you, Anish, and it starts with the quarterback. The dual threat nightmare for defenses, and then if that doesn't work, you've got Tremaine Pope that you hand the football off to, the fastest player on this team, and Josh Barge, as a wide receiver, just really likes one-on-one opportunities, and Jenkins has his confidence in him, and we'll see what happens today. C.J. Smith is has the assignment today of covering Josh Barge all over the field.
That's an offense that has put up some crooked numbers in this postseason. 625 yards per game in the three playoff contests. Jenkins, the All-American, to fellow All-American Tremaine Pope, breaks one tackle and then swallowed behind the 20-yard line by Nick DeLuca. North Dakota State's outstanding Mike linebacker.
I've been so impressed with this young man when you watch him on film. He does a nice job of fighting his way through traffic, getting to the play, but you don't see him miss a lot of tackles. And at 6'3", 244, he's the ideal size to be the plug in the middle of the field.
They give it to Tremaine Pope. Breaks a couple of tackles, gets out of bounds. How good has Pope been in this postseason? 655 rushing yards.
Jeez.
Averaging better than 12 yards per carry. He's been Herculean, the senior out of Anniston, Alabama. Bison was showing safety blitz as Robbie Grimsley stormed up to the line of scrimmage. Now he backs off. Play clock down to 5. Jenkins will run it. This is what he does so well. Jenkins looking for room, and he picks up a Jacksonville State first down. Eli Jenkins ran for 195 yards in each of his first two playoff games this season.
He's just a talented player, and you see him here. He has confidence in his running ability, and for a quarterback of his size, he really does a good job of fighting through tackles. That time there, though, I think that the Bison tipped their hat to what they may use the rest of the game, Robbie Grimsley as the spy on Jenkins throughout the game. How do you stop a skillful player like that? You put skill on him to try to compensate his athletic ability.
Running back Tremaine Pope in the slot, now in motion. They give it to Miles Jones. And Jones gets across the 35 to the 37, brought down by DeLuca. A gain of 4. Jacksonville State in these playoffs, 433 rushing yards per game. Jenkins, the quarterback, the only quarterback in the FCS with 1,000 yards rushing and more than 2,500 yards passing. Only quarterback in the FBS to do that, Greg Ward at Houston. And a flag, our first one of the game. Tony Marcella in the white hat. He's the head referee for this FCS championship.
Prior snap, ball start, 63 offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, second down.
Left guard Adam Wright, first team all Ohio Valley Conference.
And that is the interior of this offensive line for the Gamecocks. Adam Wright, their left guard. Number 50, Casey Dunn. Number 72, Blake Burks. They gain yardage in the middle, particularly with Jenkins on the inside. Three of their best linemen, all three of those guys were all conference. And that'll be a matchup to see how they can handle Brian Schatz and Tangway today for the Bison.
There's Pope. They spun down shy of the 40. It's a gain of 6.
That's an aggressive tackle there from the cornerback, C.J. Smith. Not afraid to put his head in there.
What's made Jacksonville State so good this season, and especially in the playoffs, explosive plays.
Yeah.
They can rip off a long one at any time. Jenkins looking to the sideline on 3rd and 5. Jacksonville State going a lot slower than it normally does here on its opening drive. Against a 4-man rush. That's caught by Dalton Screws, tackled immediately. And Screws is a yard shy of the marker. Jalen Allison on the stop. And it's 4th down for Jacksonville State. John Grasso, old high school coach, spent a lot of time in the high school ranks in the state of Alabama. And it looks like he's going to leave his offense out on the field, which is not surprising.
Yeah, they're going to take some time here to measure this one, though. But I want to brag on Jalen Allison. The freshman there from Michigan. That was a fine job of coming off of coverage and making a play there. And he read that play before the ball was thrown, which allowed him to get to the wide receiver extremely fast. And that was why they're even measuring here, because I think Jacksonville had the right play called at the particular time. But it was the defense there from Jalen Allison, in my humble opinion, that made this play short.
They're going to measure the initial spot. Looked like the receiver was a little short of the marker. And it's going to be 4th and short. And I would not be surprised if John Gross elects to go for it. He's gone for it 28 times this season and converted 21 of those.
Yeah, and I'd run the football. You got 4 of your five offensive linemen are all-conference players. Look, if you can't get an inch right now, you've got problems. And so I think with the skill talent that you have, along with a dual threat quarterback that's like an extra running back in the backfield in these types of situations, I think it's the right call here.
And it's going to be so key in this game for Jacksonville State to extend the drives and to keep their offense out on the field, because North Dakota State is going to bleed the clock when they have the football.
Absolutely.
And play keep away. Well, it looked like they were going to go for it, but now the punting unit comes on. Hamish McInnes from Australia, the one nugget on him that I love, because you don't see it often. His favorite food is kangaroo.
That's great. Oh, boy.
McInnes will punt it away. Line drive kick. C.J. Smith will let it bounce.
Bad decision.
And it will roll into the end zone. So a poor job there by Jacksonville State in punt team coverage. The Bison will have it at their own 20 when we come back. An early missed opportunity by Jacksonville State to pin North Dakota State deep in its own zone. Bison will start at the 20 after a touchback, and we check in with the third member of our team, Quint Kessner.
Yeah, quarterback Carson Wentz medically cleared to play earlier this week. It's been a long rehabilitation process. Talking to their strength and conditioning coach, Jim Kramer, spent a lot of time doing footwork and running drills, but they had to simulate weightlifting without being able to use that right wrist and grip things. So they did a lot of manual resistance work. What I've seen from Wentz in warm-ups, really sharp, tight spiral, very emotional. He's excited. This is a game he's been pointing to for the last 10 weeks.
Last game of his college career. Play action. Wentz throwing on the run. He's got his receiver, Zach Vraw, the sixth-year senior. And this tells you what a great run North Dakota State has been on. Vraw is the only player on this Bison team that knows what it's like to end a season without a championship.
Yeah, that's just amazing. And great report there from Quint talking about Carson Wentz and what he's been able to do. That time there, you see him move outside of the pocket. I've been surprised here just watching him in pregame, seeing how well this kid moves. We know he can pass the football, but he's a lot more mobile than you would think. And that time there, displaying that and demonstrating how good he is on the move.
Lance Dunn gets the call. Dunn pushes to the 32 for a short gain. Let's take a look at how these teams plan for success. It's brought to you by Northwestern Mutual. Ahmad, what are we looking for?
Yeah, I think the matchup to watch here will be wide receiver Josh Barge and cornerback C.J. Smith. When that is taking place, keep your eyes on that matchup. That's going to go a long way in determining who wins on the edges. But then you talk about the inside. North Dakota State's offensive line versus Jacksonville State's defensive line. I think this is where the game will be won, because if North Dakota State can control the clock like they have, it's going to be extremely hard for Jacksonville State to score points and to put their offense on the field.
Wentz to throw. Pressure coming. And he threads the needle. Pro throw by Carson Wentz. A gain of 21. Darius Shepard with another catch.
Yeah, when I found out that Carson Wentz was going to be playing, two things stood out to me. I said, this kid's either going to be a superhero after today, after not playing and coming back and leading his team, or his draft stock will drop. This kid is rising right now. I've seen him throw some balls already that, with all due respect to Easton Stick, he's not there yet at that part of his game. Carson Wentz looking mighty fine here early on in this ballgame.
Stick is going to be a very good player for North Dakota State, but right now the difference, one's a game manager, the other a game changer.
True.
There's a quick screen. Erzendowski slips a tackle, gets right back to the line of scrimmage. The ball comes out. Jacksonville State says they have it. And it'll be Bison football. I think it may have gone out of bounds before Jacksonville State possessed it.
Wow. Just trying to apply some pressure there on the outside edge there. As you see on the replay here, just a screen to the outside. And then when you watch him, he's making some move, that second effort. His knee was not down there. It looked like it was, he was still in the air when the ball was knocked loose. Wow, that's a close call.
Dawson Wells fell on the loose ball. But again, you have to possess it on those sideline plays where the ball's going out of bounds. So a break for North Dakota State. Second and 7. They gave Stick 3, and they may look at this one upstairs.
Yeah.
Previous play is under review. The ruling on the field is that a Jacksonville State player touched the ball while out of bounds prior to recovery.
Rogers Redding is the head of NCAA officials. He's with us in the booth. And Rogers, what exactly will they try to determine here when looking at the replays?
Well, what they're going to look at is to see whether the defensive player actually got possession before he went out of bounds. It looks like he's out of bounds when he's touching the ball, and that makes the ball out of bounds, even though the ball itself may not have crossed the line. So what they want to make sure with the look at it, because it's an important play in the game.
In a situation like that, what constitutes possession?
Well, it has to be clear and firm. I mean, it has to be obviously that he's in firm control of the ball. And from the replays you look at, in order to flip this, they've got to have absolutely indisputable evidence that he's got clear possession before he goes out of bounds. So I think they're going to – I'd be surprised if they flip this. I think it'll stand, maybe even be confirmed.
Dawson Wells is the one who fell on it for the Gamecocks of Jacksonville State. He's a first-team all-conference linebacker from Ocean Springs, Mississippi.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Second down, North Dakota State.
As you heard from Rogers, that was his prediction, and the ruling is confirmed. So second and seven for the Bison. They've had the ball for most of this opening quarter. And Ahmad, time of possession, according to Bison head coach Chris Kleiman, is going to be vital for North Dakota State. Jacksonville State doesn't value it as much. It means everything for North Dakota State.
Well, it's two parts here. Yeah, you're wearing down the defense, but you're also giving your defense rest. And we've seen this defense play inspired when the Bison are able to control the ball and they can go out there and just let it fly.
It is to King Frazier, transferred from Nebraska, and he's breaking tackles all the way to the 38. Finally brought down by Folo Johnson, another first-team all-conference member on that Jacksonville State defense. So third and short for the Bison, 3 out of 4 on third downs this afternoon.
Yeah, this is easy money for a guy like Carson Wentz. But here's why. These short distances, it really just forces the defense, because now you have an option to run on third down, which thins out what you can do on the back end in terms of coverage. So you see them here. They come three wides, flank to the left side of the field. It looks like they're trying to thin out the box to run the football here.
They'll keep it on the ground. Frazier broke the initial tackle. And was his surge enough for a first down? It appears so.
Great effort, though, there by Joel McCandless. Getting the backfield. That was just an explosive tackle. Ran his feet and nearly came up with a big third down stop there for the Gamecocks as we watch it here. Just explosive. Just fights through the line there, sifts through traffic. And that extra effort there from Frazier was probably the difference, but a fine there play there by McCandless.
Chase Morlock turned back at the 35-yard line after a gain of 2. We told you this defensive line for Jacksonville State is outstanding. 95, Alan Carson, who made the tackle, graduated from Tennessee in 3 years. Landrum and Sigler are Auburn transfers, and Darius Jackson had an outstanding season at the other end position. There is an injured player, and it is Sigler who was the conference defensive player of the year in 2014. 49 seconds to go in the opening quarter of the FCS championship. We'll step aside.
The NCAA FCS Football Championship is presented by Northwestern Mutual. We help you live life differently. And in part by Lexus, introducing the all-new Lexus RX and RX Hybrid.
On Thursday night, players from both North Dakota State and Jacksonville State spent some time at the Miracle League of Frisco, helping out and spending time with some special needs kids. The teams played some flag football, in case you're keeping score. The team led by North Dakota State won 42-35. Bruce Anderson in the backfield, 45 seconds and ticking here in the opening quarter. Anderson gets the call on second and 8. He's got great speed, a Florida native. He's able to pick up 4 before being spun down by McCandless and Folo Johnson.
And safety there, Folo Johnson. Now watching him on film, just a very active safety. He does a good job of running the lanes, getting through traffic and tackling when he gets there, frankly. And that time, sometimes that's hard for players to do that, but does a good job of just dissecting what the offense is doing, and he'll be a key member of them. For their team today.
It's an experienced Gamecock team. Johnson, one of 30 seniors on this roster.
Wow.
And that will take us to the end of the opening quarter. The Bison held the ball for almost 11 minutes. 3-0. The four-time defending champs on top. The numbers speak in the imperative. North Dakota State has won the last 4 FCS championships, looking for their 5th in a row. 21-1 all time in the FCS playoffs. They've won 19 consecutive postseason games. They're indomitable at the Fargo Dome. And look at that record since 2011, 70-5. For context, over that same span, that's nine more wins than Alabama, a Bo Pelini season worth. On third and four, King Frazier gets the call, and he is met right at the line of scrimmage by Jacksonville State. So fourth down from the 30-yard line, and with the struggles Peterson has had in the kicking game, I'd expect North Dakota State to go forward here.
Yeah, this is fourth down territory for sure. And that was the first time for Jacksonville State that they really just manhandled the power for North Dakota State. And they'll have to do that several times today if they want to win this football game.
Fourth down, Wentz to the air. And Vra able to hold on inside the 25 for a first down.
Wow. You can tell these guys have played a lot of football together. And right here, just a simple in route here. Looked like a slant on the outside edge from Vra. Watch Carson here. Good job of eye manipulation. He looks off the safety, wanted that one-on-one matchup. But good touch there to squeeze it into a window. We know he's got the velocity and the power behind this throw, but the touch, that's next level.
You're telling me this is a guy who hasn't played a game in 3 months?
Amazing.
Six out of nine, 59 yards in the early going. After the fourth down conversion, Wentz off play action, off his back foot. He's got his fullback, Andrew Bonnet. First and goal, Bison.
Tim Polasek said earlier, the offensive coordinator for the Bison, said if Carson Wentz was in the game, Bonnet would have more touches. And you see him here, number 46, the long hair, hard to miss the guy, but just watch him. They've been running so aggressively, it makes it a lot easier to get those one-on-one matchups. And that time there, number 23, Brandon Bender, who plays a lot like the nickel but is listed as a linebacker, got caught looking in the backfield. One thing that this staff really believed, because he's so aggressive in nature, Bender is, he's a player that you can pick on in with certain situations like that.
And Bender is down on the field as we go down to the field and Quint Kesnick.
It was interesting yesterday at the walkthrough, I bumped into a couple NFL scouts, obviously here to see Carson Wentz, but also here to take a look at Andrew Bonnet, who's kind of a wild card. If you watch him today, he'll line up a tight end, fullback, H in the slot, and NFL scouts looking at him as a fullback. But I love that play call. They finally get into good field position with the wind and on first down. Great play action.
And you're right, Quint, about what he shows. He just shows great versatility and a unique skill set for Bonnet. And you can see this guy playing at the next level at a few different positions.
Bonnet right now lined up at tight end. And he motions to the left along with Luke Albers. Jedry Sears, the fullback. Frazier, the deep back. Frazier gets the call, looking for running room. And we have a flag on the play. Demarius Miller made the tackle.
Flag of play.
Legal motion. 46 on the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty. Replay first down.
That's the All-American Bonnet, whose praises we were just singing.
Maybe he wasn't set. He went in motion one particular way, and you've got to be set. And he was actually moving forward, I'm told, as that play was being snapped, and you can't do that if you're in motion behind the line of scrimmage.
As good as the Bison have been in this postseason, an area they have struggled in is cashing in the red zone. Jacksonville State can hold North Dakota State to three. That's a victory. Despite not having the ball much, it would still be just a one-score game. Wentz throwing for the end zone. Touchdown. Right back to Bonnet.
This is not a good sign if you're the Gamecock defense. Carson is starting to carve up this defense. He's taking right now at will what he wants. That time there, just a fine job. He goes right back to Bonnet. And you can do that with a versatile player like that when you're so aggressive in the run game. And you see this ball here, just another wonderfully thrown ball in the right location. Watch the reaction from the senior here. This is a bad, bad, bad man.
The first of four, North Dakota State's first championship 4 years ago here in Frisco against Sam Houston State. It was the start of one of the great runs in the history of college sports. Only the Bison and Augustana have ever won four consecutive championships in college football. And Chris Klieman, North Dakota State's head coach, told us time of possession would be crucial. We want to talk about this Jacksonville State offense and how good they are. They just have not had the ball so far.
This is the nature of the game when you play the Bison. And this will be their second possession of the game. And hopefully this offense now knows the sense of urgency in scoring.
There's Reggie Hall out of the end zone. And Hall slams into a brick wall at the 20. He's to the 21. Now, if Jacksonville State wins today and Alabama knocks off Clemson on Monday, yes, the state of Alabama, the Yellowhammer State, would have the FBS and FCS championship. Bama and Clemson Monday, 8:30 Eastern from Glendale, Arizona. Paul Feinbaum has gone on the record and said if Nick Saban wins another title, he's the greatest football coach of all time. Do you agree?
Oh, that's tough.
Five titles in the modern era.
Well, he's certainly in the conversation. I think that's fair to say.
Eli Jenkins to throw on first down. Over the middle, Nick DeLuca with the diving interception.
Just great awareness from the junior middle linebacker, Nick DeLuca. Can't say enough about his skills and his awareness. Yes, he will stop the run, but you see him here in the middle of the field. Great job of following the quarterback's eyes. And he just undercut the route at the perfect time. And then the athletic catch, really just emphasizing why this young man is one of the top defenders in all of FCS. Fine football play by Nick DeLuca.
You've said it the last couple of times we've been in Fargo for the quarters and the semis. You're a big fan of his game. This was a kid who finished second in the Missouri Valley in Defensive Player of the Year voting. It went to DeAndre Hall of Northern Iowa. He's still got another year left, though. First play off the turnover. Wentz off play action. Looking for Morlock, or perhaps it was Vrah, the crossing route incomplete.
Yeah, first time I've seen a misfire all day today. And that time there, just a little high, it looked like he was, as you say, going to Vrah. And they had a crossing route there that kind of got tangled up. But once again, this offense back out on the football field, the worst thing for the Gamecocks is they're not able to sustain drives. Now this tired and worn down defense has their back against the wall in a sudden change situation with a very dangerous quarterback and a dangerous offense.
You're seeing some hands on hips already, still early in the second quarter, but Jacksonville State defensively has been unable to get off the field. There's Morlock, the Eagle scout, a gain of three. We go down to Quint.
Anisha, I hope fans at home get the sense for what the feeling here is in terms of this being about 90% Bison fans, that noise and confusion leading to that Eli Jenkins pick. We talked about experience all week with both these coaches. Coach Klieman denied it. Said, you know, it'll help us in preparation in the hotel, during practice. We know the routine. But I think you're seeing that early on here.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 23, Jacksonville State. Half the distance from the end of the run, first down.
That's Brandon Bender, the team's leading tackler, and maybe some frustration now on that Jacksonville State defense.
He's a spark plug for their defense, and when you turn on film, he certainly stands out. But you cannot make those types of mistakes. Now you've cost your team drastically, and even as he's walking around on the sideline now, you can tell that he's got to be able to control his emotions. You know, I know this is a big game, but that is not a wise decision.
Rozier, the fullback. Morlock, the tailback. Morlock gets the call. He spun back at the 11-yard line, so third down. Or rather, second down now for North Dakota State. You go back to the semifinals for North Dakota State against Richmond in the fourth quarter of that game. The Bison had a 10-minute drive, 80-plus yards, 18 plays, and in that fourth quarter, Richmond ran a total of 3 plays, North Dakota State 25. So far in this game, 29 plays run by the Bison, 7 by Jacksonville State. Wentz is going to keep this, looking for the edge. Breaks the tackle, reaching for the end zone. No signal yet. And they say it is a touchdown.
Now, Jermaine Huff here, the All-American cornerback, will miss here. But the play fake there was outstanding. Poor tackling angle there by Huff. But I've got to give major props to the effort of Carson Wentz. This kid is hungry. Look how bad he wanted to get into the end zone. Lays it out all on the line for his team. And if you could hear, if you listen closely, you could hear it in the background. Cha-ching, cha-ching. This kid is making money today. He really is. I mean, just watch how special this is. One more look at the touchdown and the great effort from a top NFL prospect. A nice play fake there. He beats a more athletic Huff. And then the effort there, Carson in for the touchdown.
Carson Wentz is seen as a guy who could go in the first round. Here's Todd McShay's scouting report.
Carson Wentz has everything you look for physically in a quarterback prospect. He has the size, the big-time arm to drive the ball vertically down the field, and he brings mobility to the table. I think one area he'll continue to improve will be with the consistency of his footwork so that he's more consistently accurate throwing the ball. But at the end of the day, we have a second-round grade on him now, and our recent mock draft had him in the late first round behind Paxton Lynch of Memphis and Jared Goff from Cal. Only those two quarterbacks right now ahead of Wentz going into the draft process.
Reggie Hall will run this out. And he's shy of the 20. Quint Kesnick, you spoke to some NFL scouts yesterday.
They are here to see him in person, to see his leadership firsthand, to see how the ball comes out of his hand, you know, how tight the spiral is. I think they had a big question mark about his processing speed, because this offense is kind of simplistic, but today you're seeing the ability to check down, find the open man, and then the footwork. You watch him on tape, not quite sure how well he runs. Wow, today in person, this kid is really putting it all together. His footwork is on par.
Then you throw in the fact he's been a 4.0 student for about 3 years. Crucial possession early in the second quarter for the Gamecocks. Jenkins is going to run on the read option, slips a tackle. There's the big playability of Eli Jenkins and this Jacksonville State offense.
Yeah, and the most interesting thing watching him on film, I was surprised about how many times he actually runs inside. You see him here, just a nice job, and that puts him really in the meat of the defense. But he's so elusive, and he's got a strong lower half there that he used to make a big play.
He got 23 on that last one. Here's Pope, dropped in the backfield by the true freshman strong safety, Robbie Grimsley.
Oh, I like Grimsley, but Menard there also just blew that play up and really forced the decision. But Robbie Grimsley is one of those players, when he was inserted into the lineup, this coaching staff said this entire defense played different. He's a freshman playing like a senior, and you see there the athletic ability and the talent that this young man possesses.
Off play action, Jenkins to the air. And that is caught by Marquise Merrill. He's to the 46-yard line, third and manageable after a gain of 8. And this is an imperative third down for Jacksonville State. Their offense has run only 9 plays. Their defense has been out on the field. They have to pick up this first down.
Yeah, and the Bison defense have done a good job so far of limiting the big play. But these are times when Jacksonville State likes to strike.
Jenkins on the draw play. And he surges to the 49-yard line, marked down right at the first down marker, and it looks like he's got enough. They're going to measure, but it looks like the ball is spotted right at that first down marker. And you know what? If they don't get it, down 17-0 already with the defense out on the field, I think this time John Gross would go for it. The numbers that the Gamecocks have put up in the postseason against quality competition have been just absurd, and Jacksonville State is going to be just a bit short, and I think you have to go for it here, Ahmad.
Yeah, and for most coaches, in between the 40s is one of those delicate areas where you start to think about going for it on fourth down. I know they lined up for it last time before sending out their punting unit, but this time here it looks like the offense is set to go. And if you're the offensive line, if you're Adam Wright, Casey Dunn, Blake Burks, and Justin Lee, four of those five guys were named to first-team all-conference offensive line. Here's where you make your money. Here's where the guys in the trenches really show, hey, guys, follow me. We got this.
Pistol set. Jenkins will try to sneak it through. Second effort. This is going to be close. You saw the reaction there by Trey Dempsey. I'm not sure North Dakota State was loving the spot. And Jacksonville State able to get the first down, and boy, did they need that. They needed that.
They did, and it was the second efforts here from Jenkins. You'll see initially he gets stonewalled by this Bison defense. Great job of firing off there from the defensive tackles. They reestablished the line of scrimmage, but it was the second effort from Jenkins that got the first down.
Gamecocks in the Bison territory.
Timeout, Jacksonville State. This will be the first charge timeout. This will be a media timeout. Media.
The nation learned about Jacksonville State back in week two. They were at Jordan-Hare Stadium to take on Auburn out of the SEC. And the Gamecocks had the Tigers on the ropes. If you watched this game, there was nothing fluky about Jacksonville State leading for most of the game. They had Auburn beat. They missed a couple of field goals, a shank punt, and Auburn would come back to win in overtime. But John Gross, the Gamecocks head coach, told us after that game, his team realized they could not only play with anybody, they could beat anybody. That game stuck with them. They've won 12 straight since. Ball hits the ground. North Dakota State is on it. Second turnover for the Gamecocks. They can't get out of their own way.
Faulty exchange there between Pope and Jenkins. And when you run this play, here's the worst thing that can happen on this particular zone replay is that you have indecision on the part of your running back and your quarterback. Now, is he giving this ball here? You can't tell, and that is the quarterback's fault, because you've got to make it very clear to your running back. Are you putting it in my pocket or are you pulling it? And that time there, it looks like Jenkins had some indecision. Another big play for the Bison defense as they create another turnover.
We asked both coaches, what would experience mean in a game like this? North Dakota State's been here four straight seasons, and both coaches said, once they get between the lines, it will not mean that much. Not sure about that. Wentz will tuck it and run with nobody open. And he's to the 44-yard line of Jacksonville State. It's a gain of about four. Wells on the stop.
Wise decision there. I mean, when you looked at it downfield, they were trying to get a little boot or waggle there to the outside edge, and it was covered downfield very well by the Gamecocks secondary.
When North Dakota State has the ball, the crowd has been silent, especially the Bison majority. That's how it is at the Fargo Dome. They've saved their vocal cords for when the opposition has the football. This is King Frazier, and he stood up by a phalanx of defenders. No gain. Dawson Wells, a first-team all-conference linebacker, led the charge. Check out NCAA.com, the official online home for all 90 NCAA championships. You're watching the FCS championship. We're in Frisco, Texas, Toyota Stadium, and this will be the home of the FCS championship for the foreseeable future, at least through 2020. Empty set here on third down. The Bison 4 out of 6 on third. Wentz taking a shot downfield for Shepard, who has a step, makes the catch. Another great throw in a small window.
Wow. Yeah. Just the matchup he wanted, and he went to it. He picked on it. Bender here, who plays a lot like the slot, as you heard me mention earlier, is almost like a defensive back. But just a great job of getting to the football, making a play on the ball there by Shepard. He just attacked the football. And that was a fine play there. And once again, that just gives the quarterback confidence in the guys that he's throwing to. And it gives the wide receivers confidence that this guy is going to put it in the right location.
Play action. Wentz rolling to his left. Throws on the run. Incomplete. Morlock could not hold on. Ahmad, I got to say, I'm shocked at how this game has played out so far. Watching Jacksonville State on film, boy, they looked awful impressive. Awfully impressive. They've rolled through this postseason, putting up gaudy offensive numbers. I don't think they get enough credit defensively for how good they've been through the course of this season, almost beating Auburn. But North Dakota State has dominated this football game. Offensively, they've scored on every drive and in the red zone here again.
And in all fairness to this defense, they've been out on the field for a mighty long time. And the hardest thing is to try to keep your focus when you're fatigued.
There's Bruce Anderson, the freshman. He somehow MacGyvers out of the ambush to get back to the line of scrimmage. It'll bring up a third and long. For Jacksonville State, the good news is there's still a lot of football to be played. There is a flag.
Offside. Defense, number 40. It's a 5-yard penalty. Second down.
That's the end to Darius Jackson.
Can't get out of their own way right now. Their offense, the last two possessions with turnovers. Defensively here, you probably have a great stop there, but it's negated by a penalty.
I just glanced over at the time of possession stat. North Dakota State has had it for 16 and a half minutes. Jacksonville State for less than 6.5. And the Gamecocks have turned it over a couple of times. The Bison knocking on the door. A lot of hands on the hips. But as we told you, Jacksonville State, what they have going for them, there's a team that can come back. They can score and score quickly. That's been their MO this postseason and throughout the regular season.
I agree.
We'll step aside. Timeout by the Bison. 2nd and 5, North Dakota State in the red zone when we come back. Championship number 2 in this incredible run by the Bison. They beat Sam Houston State the first time, beat the Bearcats again, this time more impressively. And incredibly, the Bison still playing, still with the lead, going for championship number 5 all in a row. We've said it before, we've said it again, we'll say it again. It's one of the great runs in the history of collegiate athletics. On 2nd and goal, Wentz pumps, open receiver. Dunn made the catch, but he could not stay in bounds long enough to get into the end zone. And now they're conferring on that sideline. Touchdown! Oh, he was in! Now they'll probably look at this one upstairs.
Yeah, it's no doubt here it catches the football, but let's see if it breaks the plane here. It's in that right hand. Does he get anything that gets inside of that pylon?
Where's the ball when he goes out of bounds?
Yeah, I'd have to say on first glance here, this looks like this will be overturned. But if you're the officiating crew, I think it's the right play because it was an awfully close call to make.
And again, it's the position of the ball when he goes out of bounds and out of bounds. You know, what's important here, again, the call on the field was a touchdown, so you need indisputable video evidence to overturn that. They're going to review that play. You got somebody's head in the way there, so you can't quite see where his foot went out of bounds.
Ruling on the field, it's touchdown.
We have Rogers Redding, the head of NCAA officials, in the booth. Rogers, when you saw it in real time, what did you see?
In real time, it looked like that he was short, that he did not get that ball inside the pylon. Now, the rule is that if he gets outside the pylon with the ball, if any part of his body touches in the end zone, that's okay. He gets the extended goal line. He does not get the extended goal line if something about his body doesn't touch in the end zone.
Okay.
So he's got to get it over the pylon or inside the pylon. If he goes outside the pylon with the ball, then something's got to touch the ground in the end zone. Now, it's very hard to tell, you know, did something touch that pylon right there? I mean, it's hard. It's really hard to tell if this is going to be. It's obviously very close. That's why they're looking at it. But the replay official's got to have indisputable evidence that he did not touch something in the end zone in order to flip this to an overturn.
And I'm telling you, the gentleman with the bald head whose dome obstructs the foot of Dunn, that might work in the favor of North Dakota State because you can't quite see where his foot goes out of bounds with the ball. And Rogers, again, this goes back to why the ruling on the field is so critical
that's
in these situations.
Right. I mean, that's exactly right. The ruling on the field is...
After further review, the ball carrier went out of bounds at the half-yard line. Without hitting the pylon, he does not get goal line extended. North Dakota ball, first down, goal to goal, half-yard line.
That's a good outcome. They didn't get the goal line extended because no part of his body touched the ground in the end zone since the ball did not go over or inside the pylon. So that's a good outcome.
So instead, the Bison will have the ball at the half-yard line. This might be Carson Wentz right up the middle. That's Frazier waltzing in. I should say, the extra point hasn't been kicked yet, but 13 points so far off of turnovers. And given North Dakota State's propensity to hold on to the ball, here Jacksonville State, there's not going to be a ton of opportunities left for you to come back into this game. They have to start maximizing those.
Yeah, and I'm starting to look at the sideline there for the Gamecocks because now you need a leader to emerge. Typically, you want it to be your guy, Eli Jenkins, to step into this huddle and tell everybody, look, guys, we're going to be okay. Because right now, it's really starting to all roll downhill. And this is the last team that you want to be able to have a lead like this that can milk the clock, get into what they would call their four-minute offense that they run throughout the course of the game. This is not the position you want to be in.
As North Dakota State continues its drive for five, other great runs of at least five consecutive championships. UCLA men's basketball, Hobart men's lacrosse won 12 consecutive championships in Division III. Northwestern women's lacrosse, five straight titles and then seven straight titles. Concordia volleyball won seven consecutive from 2007 to 2013. Iowa wrestling from 1995 to 2006 in a row. And Augustana football, they and North Dakota State, the only schools to win four consecutive titles. All will stay put. Jacksonville State ball to 25. Quint Kesnick, by the way, was an All-American goalie at Johns Hopkins in lacrosse, so he knows a little something about that Hobart run, 12 in a row. That's been impressive, huh?
Hard here. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. And they've been able to produce points each and every time they've got a possession. And going into this ball game, if you'd have thought there was any offense that could produce these types of numbers, you would have thought it would have been the Gamecocks. But this Bison defense has been stingy. and this Bison offense has been productive.
Here comes the Jacksonville State offense. Miles Jones. And he picks up about 9.5 on first down. Finally brought down by Dempsey. Jones part of the running back rotation. He's been a primary backup to Tremaine Pope, the All-American. And that's Jones picking up a first down across the 35. And a good sell that time by Eli Jenkins. You saw the defender go for the quarterback. Good sell on that read option.
You've got to account for him. Yeah, he's certainly a player that can hurt you with his feet.
I'll keep it on the ground once again. And here's Jones running with some purpose close to midfield. Miles Jones, a couple of touchdowns in the semifinal win against Sam Houston. 3 TDs this postseason.
Man, he really does run square to the line of scrimmage and does a good job of protecting himself with his pads. He's running very forcefully right now.
Play action, Jenkins rolling to his right on the run. And that is the first catch of the game for Josh Barge. 40th consecutive game of the reception, a school record. He's their all-time leader in receptions and receiving yards. Part of the reason we haven't called his name much, Jacksonville State hasn't had the ball all that much.
True.
Jones dropped back at the 45 by MJ Stump.
It's a really good job here of dissecting the play, getting inside of the offensive lineman. He took the wrong angle to beat that block. You'd prefer him go outside, but if you can still get a tackle for loss, it just goes to show you what type of effort he had.
High snap, Jenkins up the middle, and he gets close to the original line of scrimmage. It'll bring up third and 11. You mentioned it early. Jenkins runs a lot between the tackles.
He does. And one thing that I haven't seen him be great at is third and long situations. These are situations that he tends to struggle with. Let's see what North Dakota State does on defense.
Barge and Gonzalez, the outside receivers. Brummel and Merrill in the slot. Four-man rush. Jenkins tackled from behind by Nate Tangway, the all-conference nose guard. And it's fourth down for the Gamecocks.
Just an athletic play there from the nose guard. And you watch him here. Watch his ability. He beats the block, but look how he moves laterally to be able to get back down the line of scrimmage and tackle a much more athletic Jenkins. A fine play there, and even the awareness to try to strip the football.
It's the FCS championship. You're down 24-0. I can't argue with Coach Gross. Well, now the punting unit comes on.
That's a coaching mistake.
Hang on a second. They're going to call timeout, so maybe John Gross wants a little more time to mull this over.
Jacksonville State. What
would you do?
It's your second charge timeout.
Well, clearly, just from watching the sideline, there were several coaches that looked like there was miscommunication on the sideline. And I'm not sure what I would do, but if you're John Gross, what you've got to be able to do right now is get your ball club together. Get them believing again that they can win this football game. And so if you go for it on fourth down, now you give, for the third consecutive possession, a short field to an offense that scored at will. I'm not sure if it's the wisest decision. I'd make them drive the length of the field, and especially with 3 minutes and 15 seconds, and it looks like that's what he's going to do, is send the punting unit out.
Jacksonville State does get the ball to start the third quarter, as Hamish McInnes, the senior from Australia, will punt it away. CJ Smith, fair catch signal, and he makes it at the 10. We go down to Quint.
Anish, while this game appears like it's heading towards blowout city, one thing I want to bring up that we learned during bowl season is you had some lopsided games early. Remember Utah jumping up on BYU and the Cougars fighting back to make that a game? And then how about TCU, Oregon?
Oh, yeah.
So this game has that type of feeling. Like, there's no way this could ever be a game as it is right now, 24-0. But maybe one thing we learned from the bowl season is it starts with one play. And if Jacksonville State can find that one play, who knows, maybe they can get it rolling.
This is a Jacksonville State defense that's been opportunistic this season. 17 interceptions. They've recovered 8 fumbles. And we know offensively they've relied on the big play. That really hasn't been there so far. The challenge against a team like North Dakota State is, we saw it in the semifinal against Richmond. The Spiders had one drive the entire fourth quarter. You just don't get as many possessions because of their style of play. There's Shepard on the screen. And he spins out of bounds at the 15-yard line. Not under 2 minutes, so the clock will continue to run. North Dakota State with 2 timeouts. In the championship game last year, the Bison trailed with less than 2 minutes to go, had 3 timeouts. Carson Wentz drove his team the length of the field and scored the game-winning touchdown on a QB keeper. This is Lance Dunn. He's dropped after a short gain by Dawson Wells, who's had a nice first half. A lot of ways to watch the college football playoff championship. We have our MegaCast film room, a great watch on ESPN2. The Homers telecast on the U, of course, the regular broadcast on ESPN. And you can even get the home team radio call streaming live on Watch ESPN. A lot of options.
That's good. I need them all.
Third down here for North Dakota State. The Gamecocks get a stop. We'll have an opportunity to get on the board before halftime. That's to Zach Brown, who makes the catch over Jalen Hill.
Everybody plays better when you insert a dynamic player into the game like Carson Wentz. Now, this is what you call a back shoulder fade. Extremely difficult to defend from a defensive back position. And cornerback Jalen Hill are the game's Cox's best corner. That time there, though, with the way that Vrall jumped, the timing, the location of the ball, it's extremely difficult to stop.
Vrall had a play similar in the regular season, went over the DB's back or shoulder to make the catch, and then he landed on his feet, spun, and went into the end zone. I think it was the Western Carolina game. Now you look at ball control. North Dakota State has had the ball for almost 19 minutes. That's their M.O.
Jeez.
They'll play keep away. And you look at what they've done in the postseason. All 3 teams they've faced in the playoffs have been held to a season low in yardage.
Yep. That defense is fresh.
On 2nd and 10. Little screen to Dunn. He's going to be ambushed almost immediately. Wells again with the tackle. Third down coming up. Wentz wants to go quickly. Bison still have 2 timeouts left. Let's see how aggressive they are with a 24-0 lead.
That was great awareness there from the Gamecocks defense as the Bison were trying to slip in a running back screen there.
Timeout, Jacksonville State.
Jacksonville State will stop the clock with 1:03 to go. Final timeout of the half for the Gamecocks into John Gross. There's Chris Kleiman. He took over for Craig Bohl. Bohl had led the Bison to 3 straight championships. Kleiman looking for his 2nd in a row. A longtime assistant coach in his career. He was at Northern Iowa. He was the defensive coordinator at North Dakota State before being promoted to head coach.
Kleiman earlier in the year told us too, he said this run gets harder every year. You know, these players understand what they're protecting and what they're trying to accomplish is something that is in rarefied air. And as a head coach, one thing that I love that they've implemented with their program, they don't allow their players to wear any old championship gear. Every year is a new season. And that to me really shows the humility of this program, and they understand what's going on, and it's led by Chris Kleiman, who's done a fine job of leading these players.
You know, we saw with Ohio State this season how hard it was to repeat. Buckeyes fell short of the college football playoff. At North Dakota State, they recruit kids who've been passed up by the Minnesotas, the Iowas, the Nebraskas, So they come to Fargo with a bit of a boulder on their shoulder. Quarterback draw. Wentz has the first down and more across midfield and into Jacksonville State territory, a gain of 15.
Yeah, that time there, a designed quarterback run as they're looking to press the gas here and go up-tempo.
There's a man down for Jacksonville State. It's Rashad Byers. Coming up on the halftime report, we hear from Dabo Swinney and Nick Saban, sound from Media Day, and get some of the FCS stars of the past. All that coming up on the halftime report. I tell you what, maybe a few years from now, Carson Wentz has a chance to be one of those FCS stars from the past. His future's looking pretty good. His present's looking pretty good, too.
Yeah, there's a lot of sunshine around that man's future, for sure.
And dollar signs.
No question.
I'll tell you what, Kevin Weidel, who works with Todd McShay in our Scouts Inc. group, was telling me from his scouting friends in the pros that he thinks Wentz will see his stock skyrocket once he gets to the Senior Bowl and once Pro Day rolls around. Kevin told me you're looking at a guy who might be the first or second quarterback taken when all is said and done. He's going to take a shot downfield for Brock. Tipped by Jalen Hill. And did Hill come up with it? He did. What an interception by the junior from Marietta, Georgia.
They may not score here, but maybe that's the play they need to really get this defense going, to gain some confidence, and for this offense to come back out. He really spent this thing. He put it downfield. There's no question about it. Just great awareness there from Jalen Hill at 6 foot, 175 pounds. He's long enough and rangy to break that play up. And then watch the concentration here to really finish off this play. No question about it. That's a top 10 Sports Center play for sure. And Wentz knew. He took a shot. Didn't pan out well for him.
Only drive of the half where the Bison did not score. That was the fourth interception of the season for Hill, a team high. Let's see what the Gamecocks can do in the final 35 seconds. Not much there for Tremaine Pope. 1,700 yards plus coming into the game. Just seven in the first half. Here's Pope, tackled by DeLuca, and that will be the final play of this first half. For the first time this season, Jacksonville State in this dynamic offense is held scoreless in the first half.
Amazing.
The four-time defending champions dominated the first 30 minutes in Frisco. North Dakota State with a 24-0 lead. Quint is with the Bison head coach.
Coach, you downplayed experience all week long, but what impact do you think it had in the first half?
Well, Carson Wentz, a pretty good football player, and he settled our offense down. I thought we played really well offensively. We're able to control the clock, but it's only 30 minutes. We got a tough 30 minutes to go against a really explosive football team.
How would you best characterize what Carson's been able to do?
He's just a poised kid. Stage is huge. He loves a big stage, and he's playing really well.
Thanks, Coach. Anish.
All right, thank you, Quint. North Dakota State seeking a five-peat. They're halfway there.
Back it on up. Fill your cup up. Let's tear it.
Welcome into the Halftime Report. I am Doug Kazarian. Second half coming up in just a little bit. Of course, the FCS, no stranger to producing quality games and teams. Yes, that level of college football has produced several NFL players over the years. Gene Wojciechowski refreshes our memories of some legends that originated at the FCS level.
Sweetness. Rice. Sims. They didn't play in football palaces. Nobody sent a camera crew to see what hat they'd choose on National Signing Day. Warner. Williams. Westbrook. Nike didn't customize their uniforms. Garmin couldn't find their campuses. Moss, Owens, Romo. Their scores were on the Agate page, not the front page. Keith Jackson never whoa-nellied them.
It's a pitch to Moss on the end around.
McNair, Jaworski, Allen. Maybe they were 2 inches too short, 2/10 of a second too slow. Or maybe, just maybe, the big school recruiters had rocks for brains.
And it is caught and a touchdown.
Jones, Buchanan, Dent, Joyner, Cruz.
Pass the defense is Cruz. Touchdown, Giants.
Go ahead. You take the big school players, the FBS players. I'll take the FCS guys, the Blunts, the Browns, the Longs, the guys with chips on their shoulder pads. And just to be fair, we'll spot you a touchdown.
I like that, spotting a touchdown. 1.5 games left in this college football season. Today, media day for the FBS title teams. You'll hear from both coaches one-on-one.
BYOG was just popped into my head at that moment.
I can't give you guts, and I can't give you heart. And tonight, it was BYOG, bring your own guts.
Bring your own guts is saying that, you know, you have to give it all you got. Those are the little things, the small things that just have to come out of yourself.
They do all they can do. They're prepared. They can watch as much film. They can give us a game plan. They can give us all they got. But at the end of the day, the players got to make plays.
I had been talking to him about Secretariat and the size of his heart. Cut him open. And I was like, that's on you, man. I mean, you got to bring that.
We're just going to have to come together and support each other and just go out there and fight for each other.
Dabo Swinney has certainly changed the culture at Clemson. Now one win away from the FBS record of 15-0. No team has ever done that in FBS. And the Tigers' first title in about 3.5 decades. Now Alabama, much different story. Tied looking for their fourth title in the last 7 years. Earlier today was media day out in Arizona. And for a one-on-one interview, here's Sam Ponder with Dabo Swinney.
Coach, you did this at the Orange Bowl. You know you're going to be asked a lot of questions. What question are you most sick of answering?
Maybe about my dancing or something. I have no idea.
So much interest about that.
Yeah,
though.
Yeah.
What do you say to your guys before media day?
Well, I hope I didn't just wait till the day to prepare these guys. Try to prepare them year-round to be able to handle themselves in whatever situation that they're in. So just got to be themselves, be who they are.
Coach, you're always good for an interesting quote or two, but when it comes to your players, who do you think will get the best quotes from today?
Probably Mac Lane or Guillermo, maybe Ben Boulware, Shaq.
So you're saying you got some personalities this team?
Yeah, we got a lot of personalities on this team, no doubt.
No doubt, and it starts with their head coach. Now, Clemson last won the national championship in 1981. Look at the parallels between that season and this year for the Tigers. First opponents of the season, Wofford. Both of their coaches attended Alabama, and each team appeared in the Orange Bowl with a similar margin of victory throughout the season. Now for the 2-seed Alabama, here's Tom Rinaldi with Nick Saban.
Welcome to Media Day. I have to begin by asking, when's the last time you were asked a question you genuinely wanted to answer?
I can't really remember.
How much do you care about or monitor what your players have to say today?
Well, you know, we want our players to emphasize the things that we're trying to focus on, not really make comments about the other team in any way, shape, or form. And, you know, hopefully our guys will do that. But, you know, back to your first question.
You had to have some time to think about it.
You know, I really don't like to tell the other people that you're playing against through the media anything that you're thinking or that you really want to try to do in the game. So you got to be a little guarded sometimes. But at the same time, you know, the media does a tremendous amount to promote our game as well as our players. So I want everybody to know I really realize the importance of these kinds of things.
Really?
Yes.
Have some fun.
I will.
Thanks, Coach.
Hey, I saw a smile from Nick Saban and a snazzy Argyle sweater. So where would this run, if Alabama is able to win Monday night and capture its fourth title in the last 7 years, rank all time? Well, only one other program, Notre Dame, in the 1940s, won at least four titles in a seven-season stretch. Up next on the Halftime Report, we'll check in on the NFL, some coaching news, and a playoff preview. NFL playoffs get going this week, and it all starts later today with the Chiefs at the Texans on ESPN and ABC. That's 4:20 Eastern for preview. Here's Mike Tirico and John Gruden, who will call the game.
Well, John, you want to look at the stars in a playoff game, and the coaching staffs do that as well. And how do we control those stars, not let them ruin the game for you? Let's take the Houston best players. DeAndre Hopkins, the third-year wide receiver. He wants to see his Clemson Tigers win it on Monday, but he wants his Houston team to win on Saturday. How does Kansas City prevent him from winning?
Well, Kansas City's very confident in their corners. They have Sean Smith on one side, a veteran player, and on the other side is Marcus Peters, who might just be the rookie of the year on defense. He has 8 interceptions. Kansas City's going to say to Hopkins, bring it on. It's going to be a great matchup. Corners against a great receiver. Who wins?
All right, so if you're Kansas City's offensive meeting room, it's J.J. Watt, first line on the board. What do we do with him? So how do you keep him from ruining the game?
It's hard because you don't know where he's going to be. Is he going to be on the left? Is he going to be at the right? I mean, Romeo Crennel moved him to middle linebacker last week. So you really don't know where J.J. Watt is going to be. You better throw some quick passes, move the pocket a little bit. Don't even look past Andy Reid from running that read option to try to slow him down.
A lot to deal with Hopkins and Watt, two of the big stars in Saturday's wild card game here in Houston.
Gentlemen, thank you. Looking forward to that. As for tomorrow's action, Seattle's Marshawn Lynch out. Didn't even travel with the team to Minnesota. Beast Mode had abdominal surgery about a month and a half ago. Remember, Thomas Rawls also out for the Seahawks. Cross the Dolphins off the list. Miami has hired Adam Gase as its next head coach. He's now the youngest in the NFL. The 37-year-old most recently served as the Bears offensive coordinator. It's now Miami's 9th coach in the last 16 years. Could we see Tom Coughlin resurface with a Giants rival? The Eagles have requested permission to interview Coughlin. That's according to Adam Schefter in Fox Sports. Of course, Coughlin won 2 Super Bowls in his 12 years with New York. What to watch for later today, Baylor faces 13th-ranked Iowa State. The Cyclones have won 30 of their past 31 home games. Only loss coming against the Baylor Bears last season. That game tips off at 3 Eastern right here on ESPN2. A whole lot of college hoops on the ESPN networks throughout a busy Saturday. At the bottom there, number 1-ranked Kansas coming off that triple overtime win over Oklahoma on the road in Texas Tech. Second half of the FCS title game.
It is pronounced Bison, not Bison, the Bison, halfway to a 5th consecutive national championship, looking for a 20th consecutive playoff win. The FCS championship is presented by Northwestern Mutual. We're at Toyota Stadium in Frisco, Texas, North Dakota State, going for a 5th consecutive championship in Ashraf Ahmad Brooks. Quinn Kesnick down on the field, 24-0. The most amazing part of this first half, Carson Wentz
hadn't played since mid-October, been out with a broken wrist. We knew he was a potential first-round pick, but he comes into the game, and from the get-go, this guy looks like he's in midseason form for North Dakota State.
He has uncanny playmaking abilities, and he showed a few different things that really impressed me when you watch him on tape. He showed touch, timing, and toughness. Watch the touch here on. We've heard about his ability to throw downfield. Now watch the timing, the squeeze into Bonnet is tight in there. And then the toughness here, the run to get into the end zone, just fearless. Great finishing effort there, but he's had some help on the defensive side of the ball. And watch the defense here. You've got defensive linemen tracking down the dual threat quarterback Jenkins. You've got linebackers coming up and stuffing the run. And you've got members of the secondary flying around, Nick DeLuca doing his thing as well. And then the forced turnovers there, the miscommunication, mishandled snap, and Nick DeLuca with a fine job of getting underneath the route. This has been a total team effort. And I hate to say this, but North Dakota State has won the special team phase the last 2 weeks. They haven't even had to worry about the special teams because their offense and defense right now is playing at such a high level.
The Bison scored on all but one of their first half drives. And going into halftime, we wondered, would this second half be a comeback or a coronation? Now, Jacksonville State, capable of putting up big numbers in the quarterfinals against Charleston Southern. Look what they did in the second half. Most impressive, Jacksonville State only ran 30 plays and were able to put up 40-plus points. Reggie Hall running laterally. He's got the 20 and dropped to the 26. Quint Kesnick spoke to Jacksonville State head coach John Gross.
That was our most uncharacteristic first half of the entire season. I asked him, where do you find rhythm? He says, it starts one play at a time, having some success, and hopefully that'll snowball. Defensively, look for them to maybe turn up the heat a little. We felt that a couple of those third downs, they were an inch away from getting to Carson Wentz, so look for more blitzing. The one thing in East that has stood out all ball game long, Bison tackling in space. They've been excellent winning those one-on-one tackles in space.
Jenkins will keep it on first down, and he's brought down by the corner, C.J. Smith. Well, they don't miss tackles, the Bison.
Yeah, Quint just said it. Great tackling in open space. And this time here, I love to see it from the members of the secondary. You know, they're the smaller guys. They're supposed to be the pretty boys. This time here, C.J. Smith saying, I'm a complete defensive back. I'll come up and stick my helmet in there. And that's the second time today I've seen him make a forceful tackle.
After a loss of three, Jenkins over the middle. He's got Dalton Screws. That's his slot receiver, and Screws to the 33. Dalton Screws, a redshirt junior out of Anniston, Alabama, the FCS Scholar Athlete of the Year, 3.99 GPA in biology. Bison showing blitz. Now they'll back off. You're going to tell me this is a neutral site game?
Hard to believe.
Pope. He's going to be close to the first down. Got a little spin at the end to get near the marker. And it is enough for a first down. Tremaine Pope came into this game leading the FCS in yards per carry, better than 8 yards per carry on the season. 6 carries, 17 yards, and that's a theme. The Bison against 3 of the top 11 running backs in the FCS that they had faced coming into the game had given up just a total of 40 rush yards. Jenkins pumps, now scrambling. Nobody open, and Jenkins gobbled up right at the line of scrimmage. Maybe got a yard.
Great job of pursuing the football there on the part there of the Bison defense, doing a nice job there. Ambrosius chasing the ball down with great effort and energy. And Jenkins there didn't have anywhere to throw the ball downfield and opted to do what most scrambling quarterbacks would do, run the football, but Bison defense not having it.
Pope to the 44-yard line, a gain of six. It'll bring up a third down for Jacksonville State on the season, 45%. 2 of 5 so far today. Yeah, those 655 rushing yards all in the postseason. He had two games in the playoffs where he went over 200 and did it in less than 20 carries. On third down, Jenkins, QB draw. He's got the first down, and there's the big play by Jacksonville State. Finally brought down by Dempsey. They only had one play of more than 20 yards in the first half. Jenkins explodes for 46.
Yeah, and this offensive line does a good job of just finding him that little bitty crease that he needed to get to the second level. Jenkins, for the second time today, with an explosive play. And in fact, that's the only two explosive plays I can remember from this Gamecocks offense.
Pope looking for running room. Well, you get a touchdown, there's plenty of time left. Down 17. All of a sudden, it's a new game.
Yeah, it is. And you've seen throughout the course of the season that this team can put up 21 points in a quarter like that in the blink of an eye. So, yeah, you're going up against a dangerous offense, but if you're the Bison defense, you just want to make them earn every yard they get.
Jenkins, keeper. Jenkins! And Jacksonville State is on the board.
And that looked like the Gamecocks offense that we've seen all season long. Good job there of converting on two third downs, and then they come back here right back up the middle with Jenkins and the finishing effort on the part of the quarterback. He runs more like a running back, if you ask me, the way he breaks tackles, and he's done that all season long. The All-American quarterback Jenkins leading his team, and that is what the Gamecocks needed to get back into this ball game, to have the confidence that they can move the ball on this Bison defense.
Well, if you thought Jacksonville State needed a prayer, it's Eli Jenkins, the son of a preacher man, to the rescue. Gamecocks on the board. Eight more Bison, good in theory. I got to meet North Dakota State's live mascot, Corso, in the hotel parking lot yesterday. It's a big boy.
Now tell
I thought he was going to eat me.
Now tell the real truth. You didn't even want to pet him. You were that scared.
No, I tried. And let me tell the story. Ben, Greg, and Tom, three of his handlers. His name is Corso, by the way, named for our beloved coach, Lee Corso. And he said, hey, do you want to meet Corso? And I said, sure. And his trailer was in our hotel parking lot, so I ambled over, and he was looking out the window, and they said, go ahead and pet him. And I tried, and then he snorted. Then I tried again, and he kind of charged right up against the wall of the trailer,
gracious.
And I saw the horns, and I said, no, you know what? I'm good.
Oh, boy.
Bruce Anderson to the 17. He had two kick return TDs in this postseason. Well, Jacksonville State got its offense straightened out on its first drive of the second half. Now they got to get some stops on defense and give their offense more possessions here in the second half.
And about that last drive, you're right. Four carries, 47 yards on that particular drive for Jenkins. But it's been their inability to be able to stop this Bison offense that's really hurt them the most. So if you're this Jacksonville State defense, you've got to come out here, make sure you set your jaw, and get ready for a battle.
North Dakota State had the ball for 20 minutes in that first half. And there's Lance Dunn right into the teeth of that Jacksonville State defense, driven down for a loss of two by Darius Jackson.
Yeah, that's certainly a positive sign. It's the bread and butter play for the Bison. The power in the A-gap. That time there, just a great job of defending the play. And they got numbers to the ball. There were red hats surrounding the football. You like to see that team defense if you're a Gamecocks fan.
Jackson this season has breakfast in opponents' backfields. 19 and a half TFLs. That's a school record for a single season. Number two on that list, Chris Landrum, who plays opposite Darius Jackson. Pressure. Wentz takes a shot downfield. Incomplete. There is a flag. We heard from Quint Keshnick. Jacksonville State would show more pressure here in the second half.
At that time there, opting for six-man pressure. Wentz and a few of his offensive linemen thought that the hit on the quarterback was a tad bit too late and let him know about it.
Offsides. Jacksonville State, number 40. It's a 5-yard penalty. Second down.
I believe that's the second offsides penalty on Jackson.
Yeah, I mean, he's one of those players that likes to get every last inch in terms of being able to rush. But you've got to be careful. There's that fine line. And, you know, he's quick enough with his ball get off to still be able to beat a player with his, you know, an opposing player. So if I'm him right now, you've got to slow that charge down and do what's right for your team. You can't have those costly penalties.
Out of the ace formation, that's two tight ends, one running back, Frazier. He plunges forward to the 23-yard line. Third down coming up. Four to go. North Dakota State had struggled on third downs for most of these postseason games, but they've been pretty good today. In fact, Ahmad, we saw the quarterfinals and the semis in person up in Fargo. This is the best the Bison's offense has looked by far.
Well, when you've got Carson Wentz on third down, you know, the way you call plays and the ability you have as a play caller for Tim Polasek is to say, you know what, I can do whatever I want because this guy is a reliable threat on the football field.
And Wentz wants a timeout to talk it over on third and four. Jacksonville State needs to stop the Bison, looking to extend the drive. There is the previously mentioned North Dakota State live mascot, Corso, doing a little grazing. He's 1,500 pounds, and his handlers told me yesterday he'll get to about 3,000
wow.
Bills.
Oh, boy.
Tell you what, he looks smaller there than he did last night when I met him at the trailer.
Of course he does.
So did I, by the way. Third and four. Wentz pumps, throwing underneath. And Erzendowski makes the catch right at the marker. And it's going to be a first down for North Dakota State. We've seen Wentz do that three or four times today, third and medium, and able to get that first down with the throw.
Yeah, I've been so impressed with his accuracy, you know, having not played. That time there, low and away. That is textbook. That's what you're taught, to throw the ball in that location to prevent that defensive back from being able to reach around and knock the ball down. Another big conversion for this Bison offense as they continue to eat at the clock.
There's Bruce Anderson on the stretch play. Not anywhere to go. Folo Johnson among the white shirts getting in there for Jacksonville State.
Yeah, this defense has come out with much more energy.
NCAA.com, the official online home of all 90 NCAA championships. And Toyota Stadium in Frisco will be the home of the FCS championship through at least 2020. That was announced recently. Watch Bender 23 showing blitz off the edge for the Gamecocks. Here he comes. It's picked up. Wentz's throw, and that is caught by Erzendowski. When he got rid of it, I thought Huff had a read on it and was going to take that back the other way.
Wentz is the complete package. Here you see him recognize the blitz at the line of scrimmage. He changes protection, which gives him the time to throw this football. Now, this is great concentration here by Vraw, and we saw him versus Richmond make a few more plays. Pardon me. Erzendowski there with keeping his feet in bounds. And these offensive players on the outside edges are really taking advantage of one-on-one coverage right now.
Sideline throw against a third-team All-American in Jermaine Huff. Wentz dragging tacklers to midfield. And he appears to have another first down for North Dakota State. Midseason form for this kid.
This is just outstanding. It really is. I mean, he's putting on a clinic right now in terms of why this young man is the best quarterback in FCS. With all due respect to the guy on the opposite sideline who's the All-American, he's showing why he's a top NFL prospect.
You know, you would expect a little rust, having not played in almost 3 months in a live game. There's been none. Jacksonville State rushes four, and Wentz throws it incomplete. So second and 10, 7:17 to go here in the third quarter. North Dakota State out of the Missouri Valley. Jacksonville State out of the Ohio Valley all time. The MVFC 15-2 against the OVC in the FCS playoffs. And for the Gamecocks, they're the first Ohio Valley Conference team in the title game since Eastern Kentucky way back in 1982. EKU got to four straight title games under Roy Kidd. Frazier up the gut.
We have seen a different King Frazier in the second half of both of the playoff games that we've called for the Bison. It's been clear to see that the more touches this young man gets towards the end, the latter part of the ball game, he just gets stronger. That time there, you could tell. It was the physicality on that run and the energy once he got up. He's telling the coaching staff, feed me the football.
Offensive coordinator Tim Palasek told us the light went off for Frazier. He's a kid who had to be challenged early in the year, wasn't living up to expectations. But he saved his best football for late in the year as we get a timeout from John Grosch. We'll take a break. Another third down coming up for the Bison. This was North Dakota State's third consecutive championship. Craig Bowles' last one. By the time the game rolled around, he had already committed to Wyoming to be the next head coach in Laramie. And that was also the best Bison team in this run. They went undefeated, dismantled everybody in the postseason, including Towson in the championship game. They've had to work for it this year. Started 4-2, lost the starting quarterback, Carson Wentz, midway through the season. But Wentz is back, and this Bison team in control. 3rd and 1 in Gamecock territory. Frazier picks up the first down to move the chains. You know, Ahmad, 6 games into this season, and we were in Fargo, and we got to talk to people around the team and fans. I wouldn't say a resignation, but there were folks who said, listen, it's been a heck of a run. May not happen this year when Carson Wentz went down. And they looked ahead to the future, and they said, you know, 4 straight championships, great run. And then Easton Stick stepped in at quarterback, doesn't lose a game, and the defense got better. And they looked like a championship team the last 2 weeks of the postseason, and certainly they flashed it in the first half today. Here's Dunn. And he's dropped right at the line of scrimmage that time by Quan Stoudemire, the redshirt freshman. Chris Kleiman has told us repeatedly his team never feels that they're out of a game.
Yeah, he recruits winners. He recruits guys that believe no matter what type of obstacles are in their way at the time. And they play like that together as a unit. And some of the best teams that I've played on have been teams where you've got a core group of guys like they do that all believe in their abilities but believe in the team's ability to be successful as well.
2nd and 9. That pass tipped, intercepted. Brandon Bender off the tip, cutting it back. Bender, far side of the field, has some room to the 20. Finally chased down from behind. The Gamecocks are back in business.
That's their spark plug. Brandon Bender just benefiting off the tip pass there. Looked like Byers here is the one who actually gets his hands on it. He should have had the pick. But because Bender was running to the football, ball falls right into his hands. And then the run after the catch, I think, is what's going to be more important. He set this offense up in the red zone. And this is the best field position that Jacksonville State has had all game long.
golden opportunity for John Gross and his Gamecocks. Miles Jones fights his way to the 11-yard line. Gotta love his running style, don't you?
Yeah, he's come in, and he's a downhill north and south runner, and once he gets that momentum headed downhill, it's clear to see why, even as a smaller back, why this guy is difficult to tackle.
Back to Jones, and he's inside the 10, and now a big third down coming up for Jacksonville State. Ruben Gonzalez, the receiver closest to the line of scrimmage, bottom of your screen, number 15. He had a couple of TDs in the semifinals against Sam Houston State. Jenkins will keep this, looking for room. Flags fly, and this one might be coming back.
Number 7, Jenkins with the keeper.
Looks like they're going to get 58, Nick Johnson, the right tackle.
Holding, 58 offense. Penalty will be declined. Fourth down.
We'll take a look at this replay. See how Johnson got this penalty. At the top of your screen here, he's just left tackle. Keep your eye on him as the action unfolds. It's a nice job there of setting his feet, but anytime you see that jersey separated, it makes the call for the officials a lot easier to make. As this defense gets off the field on third down and potentially takes some points away for the Gamecocks.
Connor Rulo on for the field goal, and he knocks it through. He had some early struggles, but he's now connected on six straight. It's now a two-score game with 3:41 to go. So off the turnover, Jacksonville State able to get three more.
And they're well within striking distance when you have an explosive offense the way that the Gamecocks do. And you've got to go back to the way that the defense played here. Just a good job from Byers to break this ball up and for Bender to be in the right position. And like I said, right after this play was shown, the run after the catch might have been the most impressive, because had he not put the ball in that distance, maybe you're talking about a punt and not a field goal attempt where they get points. So just a fine effort there on Bender. Very athletic play there from Byers to get around him.
I liked what defensive coordinator David Blackwell told us about Bender. He's not always where he's supposed to be, but he ends up finding the football.
Those guys are called playmakers, and I can live with that. You better guess right more than you guess wrong.
That's what he said. You don't want to coach the instinct out of a player.
Yeah, one with good instincts, one with bad instincts probably won't sniff the field.
Well, new game here in Frisco. North Dakota State led 24-0 at the half. Jacksonville State 10 unanswered here in the third. And here's Anderson. He won't have a chance to return this one. Don't forget, one more major football game. This is in the FBS, the College Football Playoff National Championship, Monday, 8:30 Eastern, Alabama and Clemson. Chris Klieman and Dabo Swinney have forged a bit of a relationship. Klieman went down to Clemson to talk to Swinney and his team in the offseason, and then Klieman got a text from Dabo Swinney after Clemson won in the College Football Playoff semis, and Dabo telling Klieman, good luck to you guys on the 9th. That is today. So those two have forged a special bond, and they're both playing on the biggest stage. Now, we had a chance to see Clemson earlier this season. You give him a shot against Bama?
Oh, absolutely I do. If you got Deshaun Watson, you got a shot.
Frazier engulfed behind the line of scrimmage. It's the Tennessee transfer, Alan Carson, who graduated from Knoxville in 3 years and came to Jacksonville State because his high school coach
is his current football coach. John Gross coached Carson at Oxford High. Gross spent a considerable amount of time at Oxford before taking the OC job at Jacksonville State and then being promoted to head coach before last season when Bill Clark left for UAB. Wentz will keep it. Wentz has running room. Wentz stumbles across midfield. A gain of 29 for the big fella.
I'm not even really sure what to say as a response to this, because coming into the game, I thought Eli Jenkins was the more athletic quarterback. And frankly, Carson Wentz has proven today that this kid, though he is a prominent pocket passer, certainly has the feet to be able to escape pressure, but also can use his feet as an option, as he showed here, for an explosive play for the Bison offense.
6'6", 235, with wheels, with an arm. He's going to be a first-round pick. Book it. There's Wentz. Over 70 yards rushing now. And we mentioned it earlier, too. Once you get past how great he is on the football field, good student, active in the community, 4.0 GPA 3 years in a row. So when he takes those Wunderlich tests and he gets those interviews from pro scouting personnel, he's going to ace them too.
No question.
Bison bleeding some clock. Wentz going down for Urzendowski, who adjusted the football and makes the catch. Urzendowski had been quiet all postseason. He's come to life with Wentz back at QB.
Yeah, he certainly has. And a good job of spotting the football. Watch him here in this one-on-one situation. He gets on top of the defense, but the ball's thrown inside, so he had to adjust. Great job of putting his foot in the ground there and finalizing the play, making the catch. So many times you get there, but you don't complete the play. That time, just a great pitch and toss by Carson Wentz and the wide receiver.
He had a similar catch in last year's championship game on a game-winning drive in the fourth quarter. Morlock to the 15. We go down to Quinn Kesnick.
Anisha, I'm sure fans at home are saying, how did Wentz end up playing in Fargo? Well, he was a really good high school baseball player, and he got himself into an arm issue where he had a shoulder problem. So he did not play high school quarterback his junior year. He played as a senior, recruited the only FBS team that gave him a look, Central Michigan. Shows up on campus, and next thing you know, record-setting potential career, and he could be the next Joe Flacco to come out of the FCS.
Yeah, no question. Oh, I'll tell you, pretty good baseball player out of Fargo, Roger Maris.
He's pretty good.
Play action. Wentz, end zone for Shepard, incomplete. Good coverage by Jalen Hill, and it's third down. You look at the scoreboard and you say it's only a two-possession game as the third quarter comes to a close. I go back to the semifinal game against Richmond, where Richmond at times was within striking distance, and North Dakota State had the ball late in the third quarter. Richmond got the ball back just one more time and ran three plays in the fourth quarter. And so you have to wonder, if the Bison are able to play Bison football here, will Jacksonville State have two more opportunities? On third down, Wentz passes too high. Braw was the intended target, and it's fourth and eight. And now a big field goal attempt coming for Cam Peterson. He made one earlier from inside 30, but coming into the game, 1-for-7 in the postseason. Chris Kleiman told us he liked what he saw from Peterson in the weeks leading up to this game. He makes this. It's a three-possession game, and that's going to be a tough mountain to climb for Jacksonville State. This is from 31. Peterson's kick up. Nailed it.
And give credit to Chris Kleiman for sticking with this young man. You know, he talked about it earlier in the week in the semifinal game. They went to their All-American punter, who also can handle the kicking duties, Ben LeCompte. And when talking to him this week, Kleiman said, we're about the kids around here. We're going to stick with this kid. We're going to show him that we have confidence in him and that he can come back out here. And he's the same player we recruited and told that he could be a difference maker for this team. I give this coaching staff tons of credit for making the right personnel decisions. It was clear that Carson Wentz should have been the starter. By the way, he's come out and really led his team. And it's also clear that they should have stuck with Peterson and with the kicking duties.
Down to Quint.
Yeah, Ahmad, that's a great point because they put Peterson under a lot of stress in the last 3 weeks in practice. Impromptu kicks with crowd noise and team noise to try to test him. They also reevaluated his technique on film, and Coach said it was nothing that he did technique-wise, but he allowed the athlete to look and find the flaws, and the 3 weeks off has cleared his mind, and he is a different kicker today. And as you said, such a credit to the patience of the coaching staff.
Chris Kleiman fully admitted to us. He said, listen, guys, I don't know anything about kicking. He's going to have to figure this out, but we think he might be right going into this game. And again, you remember the Fargo Dome, those games are indoor. This is outdoors, so that was a big question, but Peterson is connected on 2 field goals. And right now it's given North Dakota State a 3-score lead with 20 seconds to go in the third. Wind has been blowing all afternoon. Ben LeCompte. This one bounces. Byers from inside the 5. Breaks free. And gets to the 21-yard line before he's tackled by LeCompte.
You know what? He's one of my favorites, no question about it.
We interviewed him after the quarterfinal game.
Just a great story, and I've never seen a punter be MVP. And
he was.
I mean, his ball placement inside the 5 and the 10 was just outstanding, and then his energy. That's what I really enjoy about him. But this is a touchdown-saving tackle. I mean, it really is. If he breaks that, Byers has plenty of grass, and he's off to the races.
Chris Kleiman told us LeCompte could be the key to the game. He hasn't punted. Didn't think it would be that way.
Good point.
There's Jenkins on first down. Gamecocks need to get going, and that one took a hop before it got to Gonzalez. Now, you mentioned LeCompte MVP. That was the quarterfinal win against Northern Iowa, where North Dakota State won that game on the strength of special teams.
You're absolutely right.
Tremaine Pope, give him 5, only 30 yards rushing so far. He came into the game with 655 yards in the previous 3 playoff games. Now the fans are holding up 4. That's for the start of the fourth quarter. When all is said and done, will they raise the thumb, the Bison, a quarter away from a 5th consecutive championship? Jacksonville State still believes, and why not? They've put up big numbers offensively all season. They need to muster something here in this fourth quarter. And Ishraf, Ahmad Brooks, Quint Kesnick, what this Gamecock team needs is those big explosive plays. That's been their bread and butter all season.
Yeah, and they haven't been able to get it because this Bison defense has been stingy. They're keeping things in front of them, and they're tackling well once they get to ball carriers. So in order for them to make a difference here and to really show a charge, they need those explosive plays.
Here's the blitz. Jenkins' pass incomplete. He wanted Ruben Gonzalez, the former South Florida transfer, and it's 4th and 5. Now, clearly, you would think this might be 4-down territory, but Hamish McInnes, the punter, will come on. Only reason I say you would think maybe 4th-down territory, I know if you don't get it, the game might be over. But we've seen North Dakota State in the fourth quarter. They've had the ball on average for about 11 minutes per in the fourth quarter in their last 6 games.
And they've got the best four-minute offense in FCS. When they need to run out the clock, they know how to.
There's C.J. Smith waiting for the fair catch. He'll let it bounce. It takes a Bison bounce. An outstanding starting field position for North Dakota State. The eyes of Frisco, Texas on the championship trophy. It has been hoisted by the green and gold 4 years running in this very stadium. And the fans certainly getting a glimpse of that. And will it be a Bison stampede, after the game? Or can Jacksonville State pull it off? The Gamecocks punted, a good starting field position for North Dakota State. Jake Frazier, there is a flag.
Illegal motion, 46. Offense, it's a 5-yard penalty, first down.
Second time they've got Andrew Bonnet with a legal motion. Let's go back to the punt, Ahmad. I know we don't advocate punting deep in your own zone on fourth and five very often, but we've seen too many long drives by North Dakota State in the fourth quarter. They're going to bleed the clock. You may not get the ball three more times, and so even if you go for it on fourth down and you miss, that might be the ball game. Punting it away also might be the ball game. There's Frazier. Second and long. The trophy continues to make its way around Toyota Stadium, and the gaze of many a Bison fan on the chip. The drive for five. They've got their own hashtag, the Fargo Frisco refrain. Might be old for a lot of folks in the FCS, but not for the North Dakota State faithful. And don't forget, we'll have the trophy presentation following the game on ESPN3. Wentz using play action. He's going to take a shot downfield. A lot of contact. The ball's incomplete, and now a flag. Byers was covering Vrah, and Vrah fell down.
I'm not sure if this was a bad play on Byers' part, because Vrah did have a step on him.
Pass interference. Defense, number one. 15 yards from the original line of scrimmage. First down.
Let's watch it here. He gets a good jam there. He's in the right position there. But I see what happened. But typically when you see that wide receiver kick up that leg, and sometimes you get tangled up with your feet and you feel like you're about to be out of a play, there's no question he pulled the jersey. It's just one of those plays, an unfortunate play call, but certainly you want to give up a pass interference before you give up a touchdown over the top.
You played a DB at Texas and in the NFL. How do you sell that?
I don't know.
Screen pass. Shepard bobbles and drops it. It's incomplete. Carson Wentz, first game back since mid-October when he broke his wrist against South Dakota. 16 out of 28, 197 yards, a touchdown, two interceptions, 71 yards rushing, and a TD on the ground. We told you going into the game, when this guy is right, he's looked at as a potential first-round pick. I think he's played his way into the first round.
Absolutely.
We talked to a lot of folks near and dear to the scouting community. They think his stock is only going to go up after the Senior Bowl and after his pro day. Wentz on the QB keeper to the 40. It's third down. And I'm sure the Bison fans have their DVRs set. The practices for the Senior Bowl will be aired live on ESPNU.
That's going to be fun to watch. Now, in this third down, you're playing for plays and possessions if you're the Gamecocks. Right now, you've got to be able to get off the field on third down. Do not allow this offense to convert and get a new set of downs, because it may be the last opportunity you have to stop them with this game still within reach.
Against a four-man rush, Wentz steps up. He wants Erzendowski to throw too high. Excellent coverage by Hill. So fourth down, and we get our first look at Ben LeCompte in the punting game, where he's been such a weapon as the trophy continues to make its way around to Toyota Stadium.
LeCompte is special at dropping the ball inside of the five. He really does put the appropriate backspin on the football to where it'll dangle down there and allow his gunners and his coverage to catch up with the football. Let's see if he can give them an edge here.
Josh Barge is back deep, averaging 10 yards a return. And here's LeCompte, the three-time All-American. And this one will bounce into the end zone, and Jacksonville State has it at the 20. Gamecocks still have a pulse with 12:39 to go in regulation.
The NCAA FCS Football Championship is presented by Northwestern Mutual. We help you live life differently. And in part by Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, the perfect combination of chocolate and peanut butter.
Thursday, both teams competed in a series of events as part of the Great Texas Barbecue Bowl, speed eating, billiards, bowling, mechanical bull riding, all part of it. Jacksonville State won the Great Texas BBQ Bowl. They're down here in the fourth quarter, needing some big plays and needing them quickly. Jenkins eludes the pursuit, throwing near sideline, incomplete. It bounced before it got to Miles Jones. Second and 10, only 29 yards through the air. Less than 200 yards overall for the Gamecocks, which is shocking. But you look at why. They just haven't had the ball enough. North Dakota State, double in times of possession, almost 30 more plays run than John Gross's Gamecocks. There's the blitz. Picked up. Gonzalez just dropped it. And they cannot afford mistakes like that at this juncture.
Two opportunities to make plays where you know you need to drive down the field. You've got to have those. And here's where the leaders of this football team have to come and say something to the rest of the guys. Everybody knows what's on the line, but you've got to make your play.
Bison rush four. Jenkins will step up. He'll tuck it and run. The ball is out. And North Dakota State recovers. Nick DeLuca forced the fumble. The Bison have it. And they can seal it with a score.
Menard there on the fumble recovery. But it was the linebacker, Nick DeLuca, one of my impact players for this game. He's just always around the football. Has a tremendous nose for it. Great instincts. But watch the awareness here. Though Jenkins is really loose with that football, not a great job of protecting it, but it was an intentional play on the part of DeLuca. As you watch it here, watch that left hand. Wham! Gets on that football. Big-time players make big-time plays in big-time games, and Nick DeLuca with a big takeaway from the Gamecocks offense.
He had an interception earlier, now a forced fumble. North Dakota State has it inside the Jacksonville State 25-yard line. They're going to use play clock and game clock here with a 17-point lead. Little reverse. Easton Stick will throw it. Receiver open. Who fell down, and it's intercepted by Byers. That would have been the haymaker and maybe the knockout punch, but the receiver fell down, and Byers comes up with an interception to extend the lifeline for Jacksonville State.
Well, it wasn't a good ball, and it wasn't thrown in the right location. I understand the creativity, but sometimes when you try to get too cute, and Paul Sex has called a great game, sometimes when you try to get too cute, it hurts you. And this is one of those opportunities. Yes, you caught the Gamecocks defense off guard. There's no question. Wentz is open. Easton just doesn't get the ball, enough juice and power behind it to be able to make this play happen. And now you've got Jacksonville State's offense back out on the field, albeit that they are backed up against their goal line.
Byers ran it out, so the ball at the 2-yard line. And Remember, we saw North Dakota State get a safety against UNI to seal the game in a situation just like this. Play action, Jenkins on the move. He's pursued. His pass picked off. They give it right back. Jordan Champion with his first interception of the season.
And Jenkins' third interception of the ball game, and another great effort. Pardon me. Yeah, so you're talking about an opportunity here for you to come back out and strike with offense. This is not the strong suit of his game, and he shows it exactly why, though. This is a fine play. They try to get him on the move, which I think is a smart decision, give him a two-way option. He's got space there. And watch Jenkins' reaction here. You can tell he knows that was misfire that leads to a turnover that now could lead to the Bison offense ending this game.
Jordan Champion, the interception, his first of the season. Last three plays have resulted in turnovers, and I would not expect anything flashy here from the Bison. It's going to be Wentz up the gut. And he's inside the 25 for a gain of four.
And if you're on this Jacksonville State defense, one thing to keep in mind, hold up ball carriers, rally to the football, run to it. You're trying to rake this football out, get it back on the grass, and get a turnover and a takeaway. You've got to be conscious. You've got to be aware of that. When you get to a pile, stick that hand in there and try to make something happen and put the ball on the ground.
Two tight ends and a fullback. Lance Dunn bullies his way to the 20-yard line. The redshirt freshman from Waterloo, Iowa. North Dakota State will have Dunn back next year as just a sophomore. Bruce Anderson will only be a sophomore. And the other two running backs, Morlock and Frazier, will be seniors as there's an injured player. Second time today we've seen Devontae Sigler go down. Sigler's been banged up most of the year. Healthy now, at least going into the game. He originally transferred from Auburn and a season ago was an All-American and the Ohio Valley Conference Defensive Player of the Year. Jacksonville State going into the season, you look at their D-line, Sigler, an Auburn transfer, as was Landrum, Alan Carson, a Tennessee transfer, and LaMichael Fanning, who's out for the season with an ACL injury, was an Alabama transfer, and those four were starting on the D-line, and when Fanning went down, Darius Jackson stepped in and has had a record-setting season for this team.
He's done okay.
Yeah, he's done okay.
No doubt about it. Yeah, they can play eight guys up front. I mean, it's impressive to watch them on film because it's hard to wear down this unit. But, I mean, you look at time of possession, it's almost impossible to sit here and think when this team has held the ball for over 33 minutes that you're not going to get tired. And it's also the style in which they play, Anish. They're so physical, so they wear you down, and then you're out on the field for that long. And when fatigue sets in, it's hard to focus, and that's when you see those mental busts, those missed tackles. And those are the types of things that lead to big plays.
The Bison line up in the old Maryland eye. It's Frazier. And he's through for a first down.
King Frazier, the ball carrier. Tackle made by number 86.
Landrum on the stop. We come up on 10 minutes to play here in Frisco, Texas. Yeah, this is not a neutral site game, folks. It's supposed to be, but this North Dakota State fan base, they get these tickets in August.
It's just amazing. You know, it really is.
And it's been like this for pretty much this entire Bison run. There's Frazier, and he's turned back by Joel McCandlish, the junior college transfer. There is, I would say, I wouldn't call it a small pocket. There is a considerable pocket of red. But everywhere else you look, gold and green. Chase Moorlock gets the edge, tiptoes the sideline, and he's going to be marked out of bounds. Let's see where they mark him out. At the 4-yard line, it's a first down.
Yeah, and the Gamecocks have been defending the power rather well, so what do? You get Moorlock out on the outside edges with Bonnet out in front, one of the best blockers on this team. Some good yardage on the edge there for the Bison.
Wentz will hand it off to Frazier. Tripped up, slowed down, and finally, it's McCandless finishing off the tackle. Second and goal.
Yeah, and who would have ever thought coming into this ball game that Carson Wentz would be the leading rusher for the Bison? And right now, that's where it stands with King Frazier with 47 yards and Carson Wentz with 78.
Moorlock up the gut, reaching. And he's going to be marked down just shy of the goal line. So third and goal for North Dakota State.
Yeah, they're trying to get back up to the line of scrimmage. Let's see where he landed here.
Remember, Wentz is 6'6 and almost 240. And he's going to plow into the end zone. And the folks here in Frisco can feel it.
If you're the Gamecocks, you're going to have to get a few onside kicks. You're going to have to shut down this offense if they do get the ball again, and your offense has to score, something that this team hasn't been able to play all together yet, and that's the reason why you see such a lopsided score.
It started fittingly with Champion. Jordan Champion, the interception, and then the four-time defending champs cash in. These fans can sense it. North Dakota State, 7 minutes and 45 seconds away from an unprecedented fifth consecutive FCS championship. Nobody had won four straight in the FCS before. They're looking to do it 5 years running. Two head coaches, two different quarterbacks, Brock Jensen and Carson Wentz. And you've got to give Easton Stick a lot of credit. Stick started 8 games while Wentz was out with a broken wrist, and won 3 playoff games to get the Bison here before Wentz could return. Hall bottled up at the 17-yard line, and we get a studio update with Doug Kazarian.
Anish, thank you very much. Moments ago, final seconds, tie game at Madison. Melo Trimble, the preseason All-American, wins it for Maryland, which actually had a comfortable lead in the final couple minutes, but missed free throws. A tough season for Wisconsin continues. Also, top of the hour, Iowa State hosting Rico Gathers and Baylor. This game will tip off moments from now over on ESPN News until you guys are done.
All right, thank you, Doug. If you've seen Rico Gathers in person, he might be able to play tight end someday. It's a large individual. Ruben Gonzalez with the reception. 7:30 to go here in regulation. Jacksonville State down 24. 3 touchdowns and a 2-point conversion each time. They'll need some scores. They'll need some onside kicks. They'll need some help. Jenkins. Set. Brian Schatz, the senior from Denmark, Wisconsin. You want to talk about farm tough? Grew up on a dairy farm. He used to wake up at 4 a.m. He'd get his workout in. He'd do chores on the farm. And then he would go to class.
Oh, and he plays with the same type of energy. Had a big safety in the last ball game to be able to really secure that ball game, and here with another big play.
On third down, low snap, Jenkins pumps. Incomplete, intended for Screws. It's fourth down. And this is go for a time for John Gross. You know, one of the matchups, Ahmad, you said to watch at the beginning of the broadcast, C.J. Smith on Jacksonville State's top wide receiver, Josh Barge. Barge has one catch, and he has not been targeted often.
Yeah, and you know what? It got to the point where they just started letting both Champ and C.J. play on the same side. They didn't really, they haven't even focused on Barge as much, and part of it is he hasn't been a factor in this ballgame.
Fourth of the season. Jenkins' pass incomplete. Smith and Gonzalez got tangled up. No flag. And the Bison take over on downs. 6 minutes and 41 seconds from a five-piece for Chris Kleiman and North Dakota State. A season ago here in Frisco, Carson Wentz led North Dakota State on the two-minute drill. And the Bison needed late heroics to get past Illinois State. Hasn't been much drama in today's game. North Dakota State has led wire to wire, 34-10. After a turnover on downs, the Bison take over inside the Gamecock 25. King Frazier inside the 20. Seventh year for the Elite 90 Award, which was instituted to recognize the true essence of the student athlete. And the Elite 90 winner, Carson Wentz. The kid can do it all, 4.0 GPA in the classroom. And incredible what he's been able to do today. He missed 3 months with a broken wrist. Had not played since mid-October. Came back for the biggest game of the year. And yeah, he's thrown a couple of interceptions. One, I would say, probably not his fault. They were going deep late in the first half. The other was on a tip pass. But with his feet, with his arm, he's been Superman when he's needed to be.
He certainly has. And he's raised his game. You know, and Kleiman said it going into halftime when he spoke to Quinn and said, this kid just loves playing on the big stage. And it certainly appears that way as he's a confident player. And today, despite not having played in a real game, has shown today that he has used his time wisely while rehabbing, and he's played at a very high level today in the championship game.
Alan Carson, an injured player for Jacksonville State, being helped off. Ahmad, you and I wondered, since we found out yesterday that Wentz would be the starter, was it the right move? Clearly, it was, knowing what we know now, but Easton Stick had played well, and we wondered aloud, is it worth the risk? What if he's rusty? How many series would you give him? And I would say, I don't know, maybe 4 or 5 plays in, maybe 6 or 7 plays in after the first pass, it looked pretty clear that Carson Wentz was going to be okay.
That was a tough decision to make. And, you know, I respect Coach Kleiman for even making that decision. It's very difficult. You know, when you've got a guy that hasn't lost a football game as a starter, it doesn't matter who you're bringing in behind him. And I've been a part of teams that had quarterback controversies. I don't see that here. This was more of a privilege of having two guys that can play football.
Frazier on second down, and he lunges forward for a gain of a yard. Third down coming up for Jacksonville State. John Gross took over as offensive coordinator in 2013. He was head coach in 2014 and this year, and this program is rising. They're not going to go anywhere, even though they lose a lot. Gross has put in a mentality. They've got a mindset. It's been an explosive offense all season with the exception of this game. You look at what they've done over the last 2 years. They haven't lost to an FCS opponent in the regular season in the last 2 years. Two of their 3 losses in that span were to Michigan State and Auburn. The other in the playoffs this season to go to Sam Houston State. Anderson ran into his own man, and it'll bring up fourth down.
Yeah, that time there, the young running back, just not patient. You know, let that blocker get out in front of you. You want that meat and that muscle when you turn that corner. Shove him at one of the defenders and go about your way. That time there just didn't display the patience that one needs to be able to run that play effectively.
Another chance for Cam Peterson. He's 2 for 2 today after having missed six of his first seven in the playoffs. This is a 38-yarder. And we're watching a confident kicker this afternoon in Frisco.
Yeah, he's a different kid today. And, you know, like I said, just credit to the staff, his teammates for believing in him. And I'm sure, you know, he had to do some soul searching as well. And you got to look yourself in the mirror when you don't perform well and you let your team down. Look, I'll never forget giving up the game-winning interception versus A&M in 1999. That play drove me my junior and my senior year to be great, because you never want to have that feeling. And though I had felt like I prepared, I let my team down. And the worst part was having to look your teammates in the eye. And so for Peterson to be able to come back, recover from this, it's a testament to what type of young man he is.
37-10. It's now a four-score game, all but over. And Ahmad, put this run into context for me. Five straight championships for North Dakota State in the FCS playoffs, where you've got to win four games against the best competition in the FCS every year.
What this tells me is that North Dakota State is as good as a lot of FBS teams. And speaking of that, in my alma mater, I'm not sure if the Texas Longhorns could handle them this year. I mean, they've been that good.
Shots fired. Let's check in with Doug.
All right, fellas, they've tipped in Ames. That game is over on ESPN News. Iowa State, 13th-ranked team in the country, hosting Baylor. It will continue over on ESPN2 as soon as you guys are finished. Let's go back to Nish Ahmad and the drive for five.
Indeed, Doug, North Dakota State just has to put the ribbon and wrapping paper on it. Jacksonville State never could get in any sort of rhythm offensively in the first half. 10 unanswered to start the third, but the Bison have then responded with 13 straight to put the game away. Edge pressure from Menard, the All-American. Jenkins gets away. He'll float one downfield in traffic. It's tipped and nearly picked off by the freshman Grimsley.
It's a great play.
Did you see this kind of game coming?
No, I didn't. And I think leading up to the week, I kept telling myself and everybody else that was asking me, is I think this is an even game, two evenly matched teams. The one thing that you can't put a stat on is how a winner thinks and how a winner operates when put in a situation, right, where it's time for them to win another title. And clearly, the Bison came out today. They were prepared. Their mindset was right. And this is why you see this program doing some unprecedented things.
Jenkins sacked. It's Greg Menard, the All-American. Menard came close on the previous play, and he gets Jenkins this time. Menard, like Carson Wentz, also an outstanding student athlete, 3.9 GPA in civil engineering. Third down and 12 for Eli Jenkins, the redshirt junior out of Birmingham. Jenkins chased by Schatz, has to get rid of it. Looking for Barge, it's incomplete. Coverage by C.J. Smith. Well, we talked about the big three, talked about them a lot earlier in the broadcast for Jacksonville State. They've had shackles on them all afternoon.
Yeah, this defense. Yeah, this is the third consecutive week that the Bison have played defense just outstanding. And it doesn't matter if you've thrown talented players at them. The way they play defense, the mindset they have, they've been able to shut teams down. It's amazing right now. You look at it, 183 total yards for this Gamecocks offense. That's a meager yardage production right there.
You know, that's been a quarter for them in some of these playoff games.
Absolutely. You're right. A couple drives.
A lot of ways to watch Monday's college football playoff championship between Alabama and Clemson. We've got the Megacast. You can watch it in Spanish. You can watch Feinbaum Film Room. You can watch Film Room on ESPN2, the Homers Telecast. And, of course, if you just want to watch the game, you can do that on ESPN at 8:30 Eastern Monday night. You got a pick?
Yeah, I do. I got a chance to see Clemson up close and personal this year, and you know that. And I've said this before. I think the difference in this ball game is going to be the quarterback play. And with all due respect to the performance that Coker had, maybe the best of his career in the semifinal game, versus Michigan State. I have seen Deshaun Watson do some things while leading his team that convinces me that he's special. And special players in those types of moments, that's usually when they thrive.
Well, here's Lance Dunn, tackled in the backfield for a loss. That was Dawson Wells who got there. I want to go back to something you said just a short while ago. I'm going to give you a chance to maybe clarify. You said North Dakota State could maybe beat Texas?
I think so. From everything that I've seen and the areas in which the Longhorns struggle. Now, and that's no pick on my alma mater. Look, there are plenty of teams
Brother,
in the
FBS. Brother, I just want to make sure you can
Absolutely.
Get home.
Absolutely. Well, I'll be fine. But it's the truth. I mean, it really is. It's the truth when you look at it and the dominance that they're strong up front.
Yeah.
They've got one of the best quarterbacks in the nation. And this defense has really shut down talented player after talented player. So I definitely think they've got the goods.
Gerald Sterling, the Wazoo transfer, with the tackle. And it's third down for North Dakota State.
But if I do need a place to stay, you got me?
I got you, bro.
All right.
I got you. Amazing job by John Gross this season, getting Jacksonville State to the championship game. First Ohio Valley team. As Jedry Sear walks off the field. First Ohio Valley Conference team to get to the title game since Eastern Kentucky back in 1982. And this is a conference, the OVC as a whole, which has been much better over the last few years. From 2001 to 2012, they lost 19 straight playoff games. Well, they've won 7 in the last 3 years, had a pair of quarterfinalists in 2013, and now a team in the title game here in 2015-2016 calendar year. For the boys in green and gold, it's another coronation coming. Carson Wentz appears to be done. Most outstanding player of the championship game a season ago. He'll be playing on Sunday somewhere next fall. And Chris Kleiman giving a lot of his regulars the rest of the afternoon off. Easton Stick in the huddle. And that should scare everybody in the FCS because Stick essentially is going to end his career as a four-year starter. 8-0 in relief of Wentz. He is a big reason why this team got here. He's not going anywhere. And that makes the Bison a contender even beyond this great run.
Indeed.
Stick off play action. They'll let him throw. That's caught by Shepard. Oh, no, they'll say incomplete. And so Ben LeCompte will punt it away. Number 12, Easton Stick. North Dakota State less than 2 minutes from a 20th straight postseason win. They'll be the first team in the history of college football, any division, to win 5 consecutive outright championships. Another update with Doug.
All right, Nish, thank you very much. Over on ESPN News, Iowa State out to a 10-point lead. This game will continue right here on ESPN2 as soon as you guys are finished. 100 seconds to go.
Quint Kieschnick will speak with Bison quarterback Carson Wentz at the conclusion of the game, and we remind you the post-game trophy celebration can be seen live on ESPN3 after we're done here on ESPN2. Anish Shroff, Ahmad Brooks, Quint Kieschnick, it has been another ride to the top for North Dakota State, and the folks in the FCS will hear a familiar refrain once again. Second catch of the game by Josh Barge, who came into the game with 90 throughout the course of the season. Mostly second string defenders for North Dakota State. Jenkins' pass.
Pass incomplete.
A minute 16 to go. Chris Kleiman was Craig Bohl's defensive coordinator. Promoted to head coach when Bohl went to Wyoming. And in his first season, Kleiman delivered a fourth straight national championship. This season was a process. This was not a championship caliber team from the get-go. They lost the season opener to Montana. Lost to South Dakota at home. Pass behind Miles Jones.
Pass incomplete.
But this defense rounded into championship caliber form. And I think you've got to give a lot of credit to what Easton Stick did at quarterback while Wentz was out.
His composure. And Chris Kleiman, who you see there on your screen, talked about it many times. He said, this is just a mature young man. And one thing needed to happen. He needed to play well. He needed to prepare well. But the other part was the defense playing well along with him. And the time that he came on, the defense really stepped it up and helped their young quarterback out.
Jenkins over the middle behind Barge, and it's fourth down and 10. We told you during the broadcast, Bison wide receiver Zach Fry is the only player on this North Dakota State team who knows what it's like to finish a season without a championship. He's a sixth-year senior. He'll be gone next year. It'll be just winners. And Fry's a winner, too, don't get me wrong. As that punt by McInnes sails out of bounds, North Dakota State, a couple of kneel downs from securing a fifth straight title.
An impressive run. And once again, you know, they held control of this ball game from the opening whistle to what it'll look like the final whistle. And even where it looked like Jacksonville State had some momentum, they get an interception. Bison come back, they get an interception. They just answered the call all day today. They played like a champion. And I believe that's the reason why today they're going to be crowned as champions here in less than a minute.
Victory formation for North Dakota State. Make it five straight for Fargo. As the Bison fans stampede the field, we go down to Quint Kessman.
A big hug, Easton Stick, Carson Wentz. Carson, 9 weeks of rehab for this moment. What was your mindset during that process?
No, I just had to trust the Lord. I know he had a plan for it, and, you know, I just kept grinding, and these guys, I owe them my life. I mean, for them to get us here and to give me this opportunity, I'm just so thankful.
How would you describe your performance today?
I'm a perfectionist. I'm just glad we got the W. I'm the beneficiary of a bunch of dudes making plays all day long.
What's it mean, five championships in a row for North Dakota State?
I think it might take a couple years for that sets in. Something I don't think we ever dreamed of, but it's awesome.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Anish.
This thing has gone from beyond a dynasty. It's an empire they've built in Fargo. Five straight FCS championships for North Dakota State. Catch the trophy presentation over on ESPN3.